so thrilled that Carrie chose. Well, it's a holiday for Carrie, for Shatner. Anyway, SLC. If you're doing the secret contest, the thing you do is SLC. Just that's what you do. Secret contest, wow. SLC.
Wow.
Oh, and by the way, if you're wondering what the damn secret contest is, I finally streamlined this. You go to x96.com, and now it's just right there. You'll see this big folder that says secret contest. Click on it, and it'll tell you how to win the thing.
It's not much of a secret if it's right there on our website.
There are no secrets here, Bill.
All right.
Because on this day,
SLC.
My God, please don't tell me Shatner died.
No.
This is Shatner saying happy birthday
to myself. Man, that's a good song. And I never knew who was singing there.
Joe Jackson.
It's Joe Jackson.
Oh, was Joe Jackson doing backup with him?
Oh, yeah.
Singing the duet with Shatner.
He and somebody else arranged that entire album with Shatner.
I was just reading a review of it. It doesn't matter who it's by, but he says, about 1 minute, 30 seconds into the song, Joe Jackson joins in, and the pair of them have a sort of ebb and flow duet.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they divide the lines up between them. Other times they sing the same words in their own style. I can't say at the same time because Shatner's pauses render any perfect timing impossible.
Yep.
but even when they're singing together, the pitch and volume is perfectly balanced so that each distinctive voice is audible. It's almost like there's a whole song going on underneath and Shatner is just adding his own effect into it. The whole song is performed in a manner that complements Shatner's style rather than forcing it into a format that makes it sound ridiculous.
It's that Joe Jackson right there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In the original Common People, that's Pulp, right?
Pulp. Yeah, listen, band. Have you got the original Common People there?
I'll be honest, it's not as good as
I agree.
One.
I do agree you with know? You, Carrie, because there's some sort of energy that... I know that... I mean, is Shatner in on the joke of himself?
Sort of. I think sort of.
I mean, I know that it's kind of not to be entirely taken seriously, but... That's a damn fine piece of music with Shatner and Joe Jackson.
Now, who put it together?
The record?
The Shatner Joe Jackson.
It was Joe Jackson and somebody else. I want to say Ben Folds, but that doesn't sound right.
That's what I kind of thought too, though, Ben.
I mean, this is good. This is a great song.
Yeah, the lyrics are
incredible. That's what make it great is the lyrics, but the way that. It's performed, it's not...
It lends itself to that weird spoken word thing that he does.
Mm-hmm.
It's not... I mean, I like the... He does a Bowie. Doesn't Shatner do the Bowie?
It is Ben Folds, Carrie.
It is Ben
Folds.
Wow.
Oh, Ben Folds.
Doesn't Shatner do the David Bowie song as well? Which one is it?
He does many of them.
Well, he does Rocket Man.
That's the one I'm thinking
of. Last night, pre-flight.
Now, this is
Dr. Demento material right?
This is just William Shatner thinking he's being really artistic.
Uh-huh. Yes, exactly.
And it just blows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is Dr. Demento show
I'm
right here.
Be high as a kite.
It's William Shatner's birthday, if we hadn't made that clear.
How old is Shatner now, Carrie?
93.
God.
And I heard somebody talking about it, said, I just worked with Shatner on a project, and he was sharp and on point and hit, the marks and did everything he needed to do.
Oh, my God, please don't tell me Shatner died.
Now, Mr. Tambourine Man is really the best.
Such a timeless.
Well, there's so many.
When at the end, when he's screaming, Mr. Tambourine Man, it's just.
Mr. Tambourine Man.
Carrie, you know what I found? I was going through my records at home because I have like I'm like a hoarder for vinyl, mm-hmm. And I don't even remember when I bought it, but I have Leonard Nimoy, a record from him.
Yeah,
he did a few. Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
He did Bilbo, terrible. Bilbo Baggins, old Bilbo.
He actually had a hit with that.
Yeah.
Someone.
I'll have to bring it in and show you.
Okay. Here's the screaming.
Mr. Tambourine Man.
Listen.
Hey. Mr. Tambourine Man.
Here we go.
Oh, that's...
And he thinks...
It's
he thought
bad.
That... Now, he claimed later on
he claimed.
No, no, I knew that it was over the top and it
but
was a parody.
You suspect that he was
I'm fully
serious
certain.
About that?
Oh,
really?
No, I'm fully certain that he thought he was bringing the Shatner genius to these songs.
Was there too many yes men surrounding him at the time?
I would think.
That's exactly it.
Oh, no, this will be great. This will be great.
Oh, you can do it, Bill. You can
get a platinum record with that. Let's do it.
Yeah.
By the way, I am not Gina Barbera. I'm Todd Newcomb. I'm back. Thanks for letting me participate.
I guess Katie didn't get a hold of you last night to say don't bother coming back.
So this is kind of awkward now.
Yeah, it is.
Well, look, I'm here now, so.
You didn't get him.
Well, see, I was going to play this song for Shatner's birthday.
Shatner's birthday.
But I changed my mind at the last second. Here we go.
I love that comic, people.
Captain Kirk, and if I had my way, I'd make it something I do with William Shatner.
I've had an advanced look at Frank Crist's list of celebrities today.
Yes.
It's all actors who have appeared in movies with William Shatner.
Excellent.
And I went through Shatner's filmography yesterday.
Hope you got Kingdom of the Spiders in there.
Well, yeah, it is not on the list, but...
Why did you bring that? I watched that maybe a year ago because I remember seeing it at the Roy Theater when I was a kid, and we just loved that movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I found that on one of the streaming things, and I was
just terrible.
Just awful. And it was great.
Now watch the Mystery Science Theater version of it.
Now when Shatner was a young actor out of Canada, he was contemporary and friends with Christopher Plummer.
Yes,
great Shakespearean actor and Canadian actor. He was really, Shatner was considered to be a brilliant young talent, and he was very good in a lot of things.
Well, if you watch those two episodes of The Twilight Zone he did.
Yep, he's very good in those.
Especially the one in the diner with the Mystic Seer, where he puts pennies in it. He can't move because the Mystic Seer won't let him. He's afraid he's going to die or something.
And then the other famous one is Terror at 20,000 Feet or whatever it is.
There's a man on the wing of the plane.
Oh, that's seeing a monster. It's a monster out on the wing of the plane.
I have that action figure.
Oh, the monster?
of Shatner in that episode.
I remember him hosting that Rescue 911 show, which was we used to watch that all the time, my wife and I, when we first got married.
But the best William Shatner TV show was a failed show. I think it was on one season.
It was. Well, I don't even think it finished.
It didn't finish the season?
I think they pulled it.
Barbary Coast, it's called. If you can find it. I'm sure you can find episodes of it on YouTube. He was a master of disguise.
And you know that's how they got him.
Yeah.
That's how they got him. We want you to do a TV series, and you're a master of disguise. You're going to be playing all these different characters. Mm-hmm. He went, acting, yes.
Yeah.
Acting, I can.
And he was all in.
Yep.
For those wondering, that song about William Shatner was a band called Warp 11, who are playing their final show soon, which is tragedy.
Really?
Tragedy.
I didn't know they played. They had played any shows anywhere.
They play all the time.
Oh, wow.
But they're playing their last shows.
They'll be playing at the Golden Corral just next to the salad bar.
It was in San Diego. They're based out of San Diego.
Well,
anyway.
William Shatner's birthday.
So there you go.
Bill, as we call him.
No. Did we just fart around?
We did.
Oh, that was fun.
This has been Farting Around with Carrie, Bill, and Gina on X96 Radio from Hell.
All right, we're going to take a break here, and then we'll come back with your check-ins at 877-602-9696. Check in with us. We like to hear from you in the morning. 877-602-9696 is the number. 33986 is the text number. You can text in that way or check in that way. But we do like to hear from you on the phone. Quickly, we also are going to do best question of the week today.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have a best question, submit it through email, radiofromhell@x96.com. Best question, any question you want to ask, and we will have a prize associated with that.
should play it. It's good. It's fun.
Well, we know not what it means, but it is time for another episode of Beat Gina. I'm your announcer, Johnny O, and this is a message for weak and nervous men.
Okay.
For a long time, we have hesitated to advertise ambition pills.
Ooh.
We were afraid that this remedy might be classed with the many fraudulent preparations on the market.
Yes.
A single trial will convince any sufferer that we have a positive cure for impotency, sleeplessness, enlarged veins, and nervous debility, which includes troublesome dreams, evil forebodings, losses, despondency, and aversion to society caused by overwork or other excesses.
Mm.
Especially recommended in cases of long-standing and where other remedies have failed. For a short time only, the price will be $1 per box or 6 boxes with guarantee for $5. Price for ambition pills will be soon doubled.
Mm.
Send money to H.W. Mordhurst, Halsted Drug Company, 74 Calhoun Street, Fort Wayne, Indiana, for your box of ambition pills. And now, here's a man who has no need of ambition pills.
Well.
He's not timid. He's not weak. He's Kerry Jackson.
You have the foreboding, though.
That's... Well, take one pill.
I'll take one. All right, thank you. The randomizer has picked your contestant, Gina. Okay. You'll be playing against Rebecca today.
Hi, Rebecca.
Rebecca.
Hey, how's it going?
Okay, Rebecca, let's toss a coin to see who goes first. It will give you an advantage in the game. Heads or tails?
Heads.
All right, Coin Toss app says... Tails, Gina Barberi. Oh, Rebecca, sorry. Oh.
You're one step further away from winning these tickets to the Hot Wheels Monster Trucks Live at Maverick Center on the 16th and 17th of September.
All right, so there's a chance that Gina could win. Now, if she beats you, what are you prepared to do in her name, Rebecca?
I will DJ a four-hour set for Provo Pride.
There you go.
Okay. Very nice.
Perfect. Thank you very much. All right. Haunted Mansion trivia.
Okay.
Because, well, the movie opens this weekend, and so this is based mostly on the rides, the questions are. So let's begin with Gina. Gina, first question for you.
Mm-hmm.
What is the name of the attraction ride vehicle that takes you on a tour of the mansion?
Okay.
Is it one, Doom Buggies,
mm-hmm.
three, Ghost Coasters,
mm-hmm.
three, Meat Wagons,
mm-hmm.
or four, Deathmobiles?
I believe it's one.
Doom Buggies is correct.
That's correct.
Rebecca.
Sorry, Rebecca, but it's your chance to tie the game.
Rebecca, in the ride, there is an area called Gracie's Study. In that area, there is a red couch. That couch has appeared in a Disney movie in the past.
Mm.
What movie was the red couch in Gracie's Study used in? Was it one, Bed Knobs and Broomsticks? Was it two, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea? Was it three, This Is the Stupidest Vacation, you drag me from home, you jam me in this dumb car, then drive a million miles away to see some stupid rat, call me when the trip's over? Or four, Chloe and the Grizz?
I want to say Bed Knobs and Broomsticks.
You want to say?
No.
Is that what you're saying?
No.
Yes. Bed Knobs and Broomsticks.
You shouldn't have said that.
No, gave you a chance.
Oh.
About that, Rebecca.
I would have said that too, Rebecca.
Oh, I know what it is.
Is it 20,000 leagues?
20,000 leagues under the sea.
Captain Nemo's couch.
Then they took it right from the movie set, put it in the ride.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, there
that's
you go.
2 points for Gina, Rebecca. No points for you. And Rebecca, I hate to tell you this, but Gina controls the question.
Gina controls the question. Let's find her. Let's get a hard one for Gina, shall we?
Sure.
All right. Who is considered the unofficial Lord of the Manor?
Okay.
This is one I did not know.
Okay.
Is it one, Xavier Atencio?
Uh-huh.
Xavier Atencio.
Uh-huh.
Two, Manifestation. Three, Walt's Cancerous Lungs. Or four, Poltergeist.
I guess I'm going one, because that was the hardest
that
one.
That was the hardest one. I think I kind of gave it away there.
There it is. I'm sorry, Rebecca.
I did it!
You got no points. No points at all.
That is okay.
You know why.
I am...
Yeah. Yes.
So happy to DJ.
Yes.
Yep, do that.
621, let's get this over with.
I think I agree with that for sure. Do that. Use that phone number, 877-602-9696. Check in with us right now, and you know, you can wish William Shatner a happy birthday. Or if it's your birthday, may you share a birthday with William Shatner. Isn't that exciting? So call us. You can also text us, 33986. Oh, Todd.
Yes, sir.
You can throw your sponsor.
Oh, sponsor.
By the way, this is this kind of organization. This is how we're number three in afternoon drive at X96. Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Friends at Nightingale College, this is a pretty good deal here. Become a nurse in just 32 months at Nightingale College, blending online classes with on-ground supervised field experience. Virtual college, actual nursing. Start your nursing journey at nightingale.edu. That's nightingale.edu. Now accepting enrollments for summer semester.
The moon is 93.2% of full. You should still have time to catch it. It says here it sets today at 6:37 a.m. And it was great in the sky this
beautiful
morning.
Beautiful driving in, yeah.
It'll be a full moon on Monday. Let's bear that in mind. But today it's a waxing gibbous moon, today being Friday, the 22nd day of March in the year of our Lord Jesus Christ, 2024. It's International Seal Day. If you like, you know,
is it a seal or is it a sea lion?
It's a seal. Okay. It's a day for all you different seal lovers out there. It's National Bavarian Crepe Day, a tempting pancake-like dessert which is made from flour. It's usually filled with Bavarian cream and then topped with fruit, glazed chocolate, and whipped cream.
I'll take two. Thank you.
It's Talk Like William Shakespeare Day.
Oh, I thought it was Talk Like William Shakespeare.
You got Carrie excited for a second.
Hang on. Good God, you guys.
Okay. You know, it's okay for you to pause, too, while we're being excited. It's okay for you to wait.
Let me just, you know. Okay, it's Talk Like William Shakespeare Day, and it's also Talk Like William Shatner Day, because it's his birthday. Okay. And so, let me combine the two. To be or not to be? That is a question.
There we go.
Oh,
there
my God. Please don't tell me Shatner died.
And there was the cutest thing is when you talk like William and I saw Carrie like this. He just, it was this physical like, woo.
It is both Shakespeare and Shatner. You ought to see Shatner do Shakespeare sometime.
Mm-hmm.
Boldly going where no morning show has gone before. It's the Radio from Hell show starring the Lords of Morning Radio. Kerry Jackson, I'm Handsome Bill Allred, Todd Newcomb is filling in for Gina Barberi, Katie for short is our producer, Macy is the wonderful assistant we have in the producer's booth, and is the dog asleep?
I don't know. Yes.
Oh.
Yeah, there he is.
There we go.
Vaxel Dan got excited again when I walked through the, because he usually sees me later in the day, but when I'm here at this ungodly hour,
That's what tires him out. He sees you, he gets excited, and then he goes, oh, I got to go lay down.
Well, we did. We went, and he knows where I keep my treats, because I love the puppies.
Can I have one?
Yeah, I'll bring in the dog treats if you take
sure.
One.
There's plenty of them.
Check-ins now, 877-602-9696, or you can text us 33986, but use the phone. Come on, why don't you?
People are texting. Second mandatory overtime Friday in a row at work tonight. Ugh, Calgon, take me away. Zane checking in. Is Todd excited that Jimmy the Wine Guy's here this morning?
Sure. Maybe he should bring me coffee because wine after getting up at 3:30.
We'll see what he has for us. You never know. Let's see. Bill just said the next great Utah word of the day, gonna instead of going to.
Gonna?
Gonna.
Yeah, I'm gonna.
Ron the Carpenter is adult coloring today. Let's see. Good friend of the program, Allison Sabo, checking in for Murray. Didn't know Shatner covered Common People, which is a great song. Going to have to do a Shatner deep dive tomorrow while I'm clearing my house. I have somewhere, I'll have to find it, Shatner rapping Caesar, the Shakespeare.
Really?
Yes, rapping it.
That I would like to, yeah.
It's in one of my favorite movies called Free Enterprise. Cardboard Chris checking in the voice of Francis from Pee-wee. Tomorrow's my birthday, and my father says I can have anything I want. And I want the sauce list, finally. Well, we're not here tomorrow.
No, and I'm sorry to report that the sauce list has been lost to the ether.
Lost.
Did you know, wait, moving cubicles? It just
got erased somehow.
Let's see. Johnny B. checking in. It's been a longer than normal week. I am ready to have a, I think he means pint. a pin put in and start today's drinking with Jimmy the Wine Guy. Okay.
All right. Oh, we got somebody on line one, Kerry.
All right. Let's go to Jeremy.
Jeremy in West Valley. Hi.
Hey, how are you guys doing this morning?
Very well, thank you. What is up?
I am driving to St. George this morning in a big rig in a diesel. Ooh. And I just wanted to say hi to you guys.
Mm-hmm.
And tell all my fellow listeners, please be kind to people in big rigs, because it is not always the case.
Not to get too personal, Jeremy, but how big is your rig?
Ooh. It's big. They call it a train, so it's a diesel truck, and then I pull two huge trailers on it.
Good Lord.
Like a double trailer.
Yeah, is it against the law to pull three?
You can pull three. I think three is the limit.
I've seen that.
I've always just done two.
It doesn't seem safe.
It does not. Two doesn't seem safe.
Two doesn't seem exactly. Yeah. All right. Thanks, Jeremy.
I have a great day, you guys. Thanks for letting me listen.
Be careful on the road there. I always wanted to try driving a big rig, but.
Mitch, the finance guy, checking in from Pleasant Grove. For all the people out there complaining about things in life, full of hate of all things against their beliefs. In the words of Shatner, get a life. Okay.
Yeah.
Murphy here. First night as my backup lead position comes into play, and I dropped a 5-layer pallet of liquid laundry soap in the third level of the racking system. You know.
Yeah. Right. I have no idea.
Meshack checking in, waking up with my grandkids in Florida. CNN, hope everyone's Friday is that great. Voice to text is not your friend. Hey, Carrie, can you play the drop of Shatner with the kid defending Captain Kirk against Han Solo? Yeah, I could find that one. That's in that Free Enterprise movie.
Do we have a bunch, or do you have a bunch of Shatner drops?
I do. I'll have to dig them up. They're all in the library, and they're with the sauce list, essentially. Yeah. Lance from Vineyard checking in. Candace in Ogden. Meg the musician, Damon the intern checking in, Ogden Oscar in Terre Haute, Cindy checking in, Crazy Cat Lady checking in. There you go. Plenty of people. They're just not calling.
Carrie, shouldn't you be celebrating Chris Pine's birthday, not Shatner's? Well,
because Pine is my Captain Kirk, as far as I'm concerned.
Right, but there is only one William Shatner.
Yes, even though he's a dick.
Traffic brought to you by the Salt Lake Film Society. See movies that you see at Salt Lake Film Society's Broadway Cinemas, Utah's home for independent film. Throughout March, see films directed by women, including Greta Gerwig's Lady Bird, and that's a great movie, and Oscar-nominated Anatomy of a Fall and Past Lives. Tickets and showtimes at slfstix.org. Well, after yesterday, I hope everyone works from home and I don't have to spend half the time talking about massive road closures.
Yeah.
It's early. Nothing to report. I did see somebody on the tech stream send in a little something, but I've lost it in all of the other stuff that's in the tech stream.
That'll happen.
Here we go. Crash northbound I-15 milepost 299, the I-15 and the 215 junction in Salt Lake County, the right shoulder is blocked. So there you go.
All right. Thank you very much. We're going to take a break, play a song. The song, by the way, on vinyl from Todd's vinyl collection.
Oh, yeah. It'll be a special edition of Todd's Turntable, which I do every afternoon at 3.
We'll have that for you next. And then Big Boy News and Frank Crist Presents, all coming up. Stand by.
Don't miss a single... We'll be right back.
I've had this for a while. 15 outlandish things parents have done to teach their kids a lesson.
Okay.
Like when my mother caught me smoking years ago when I was really young,
mm-hmm.
and I mean like 8 or 9, she made me, tried to make me smoke a whole pack of cigarettes.
To mm-hmm. make you sick. So
to
you
make
would,
me sick.
And it didn't work.
No, it didn't work. No, I smoked about 4 of them, and I just kind of kept going, and she went, oh, never mind. But this is outlandish things parents have done. Like Arnold Schwarzenegger was talking about it. He said he did some pretty extreme behaviors as a parent when he was on Jimmy Kimmel Live. He said when his kids were young, he once threw his son's mattress off a balcony and into a pool because his son hadn't made his own bed.
Well, that does that.
And another time, he
munch,
said,
yeah.
he burned his daughter's shoes in the fireplace when she didn't put them away properly. So anyway, that's where this comes.
That sounds like crazy things.
Yeah,
that doesn't sound like teaching anybody.
Exactly.
One woman tweeted, "I woke up to every single door on my car wide open, not because it got broken into, but because my dad was trying to teach me a lesson about leaving my car unlocked." So he went and opened every single door and just left them
open. The visuals.
Yeah. I saw that my son had left his bike unlocked at school. To teach him a lesson, I rode it home. I thought he'd come home humbled. Instead, he called the cops. An officer found me walking and said, we have you on camera stealing a bike. And my son said, hey, wait, no, that's my dad. It's my dad. I took all the cords for electronics away because my kid was, you know, doing them too much.
Okay.
That's the worst thing I've done. Somebody says, my parents punished me by taking away my iPhone and giving me a Nokia for a month.
There, you can make a phone call if you need to.
My mother repeatedly told me and my sister, if you don't stop fighting over who gets to jump on the trampoline, I'm going to get rid of it. We laughed and continued to fight over it. And one day she walked outside with a huge knife and cut the fabric of the trampoline in half.
See, that's dumb.
Ruined it.
That's stupid.
Why?
Why?
Because
she bought the trampoline.
Mm-hmm.
Just and destroying it is.
She bought it. She can destroy it.
I'd sell it or.
Thinking about the time when I was misbehaving as a child on Christmas Eve, my Italian grandmother punished me by feeding me Chef Boyardee.
That is a punishment.
On Christmas Eve.
From an Italian.
Yeah.
That is. My mom taught me a lesson when I was a kid about opening the door for people I don't know. One time, a Jehovah's Witness came knocking, and I opened the door and went and got my mom. A week later, she came back, and my mom let her in the house and made me talk with her for an hour at our kitchen table. Pretty mean. My dad got tired of my sister slamming doors. So he took the door off the hinges and burned it in the front yard.
Again, why was he destroying things?
That was about 20 years ago. Recently, he admitted he only made a spectacle about burning it, since he had already planned on buying upgraded doors for the house in the future. It totally worked, though. Now I use the story to teach my kids not to slam their doors. Did your parents ever do? Yeah, come on, they must have done something like that.
One year, my sister Kelly. I can't remember what she did, but my mom was mad at her, and it was Christmas time, and there were wrapped presents under the Christmas tree, and she said, like, if you keep doing that, I'm going to unwrap presents for you under the tree and give them to somebody else, and she would open them in front of her and go, oh, this is a cute sweater,
did she
young.
Do it?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
This is a good one.
That's harsh.
While on a trip, my kids were fighting over a toy in the back seat of the car. I asked them to stop a number of times. I finally reached back, grabbed the toy, rolled down the window, and tossed the toy out onto the street. They were very well behaved for the rest of the trip and every trip after that, actually.
Here's a text. My neighbor snapped his kid's laptop in half over his leg because he was on it too much.
Again, destroying an expensive thing that you bought to make a point.
But it makes a dramatic point.
You can just take it away.
But Gina, no. The dramatic point is, I paid good money for this. You are not doing what I asked you to do about it. And this is the extreme I'm willing to go to.
That's crazy. You just say, you have lost this laptop. It is no longer yours. And you take it away.
know, then they just resent you. You got to scare them. My, you know, see, it's like mostly my dad would just slug me.
My mom loves to tell the story about throwing out our $500 boombox out the car window because me and my brother and I were fighting about it.
Mm-hmm. Youngest kid just called oldest kid a fraud. So like a good attorney parent or teacher a lesson, I made her comply with an FRCP rule 9B and provide more specificity. Mm. I don't know what that means. I had a coworker who told me she was having trouble with her teenage son exhibiting rebellious behavior. So she took all of his favorite things and plastic wrapped them to the dining room table where he could see them every time he walked through to his bedroom. She said it worked. Gradually, he earned it all back. He's grown up now and has a family of his own. So she just, you know, wrapped it down yeah. so that he couldn't get them.
Not destroyed it, yeah. but.
Let's see. My family used to do Taco Tuesday growing up. I made a bad joke about how my friend's family's tacos tasted better because they made them with love. Oh. And she threw an entire taco in my face.
Well, she doesn't love you, obviously.
Yeah. My dad canceled the vacation because I didn't pack my workout clothes. I was 13 and never worked out in my life.
That's weird.
That is weird. Son wasn't handing in homework, so I showed up to class dressed like Wonder Woman and spent the whole class sitting by him. Oh, that's
shame.
That would be bad. That's.
Oh, there's one like that here. My 10-year-old daughter says, I'm embarrassing and refused to give me a kiss when I drop her off at school this morning. So I'm going to dress up as Big Bird from Sesame Street when I collect her this afternoon. That'll be embarrassing for her.
Yep. My dad found out I was smoking weed when I was younger and took all of my lighters. I wasn't old enough to buy more, so I just had weed, but no way to smoke it. Didn't take away the weed, huh?
Well, that reminds me.
Have a gas stove?
when my parents found out that I was smoking weed, they sent me to a psychiatrist.
Oh, really?
Yeah. How'd
that work?
I had to go have sessions with the psychiatrist. He said, your parents are crazy.
But while you're here, let's talk about some other things.
Yeah, which we did.
Wrap empty boxes and put them under the tree. If your child misbehaves, throw it in the fireplace.
Well, that's planning ahead.
No, see, my dad made the mistake of saying, you're grounded. Mm-hmm. You're grounded for a week.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And in front of him, I would never go, oh, no. Oh, you mean here?
Here where my things
where my
are?
Stuff is? Oh, no. He then figured it out.
Oh,
because then he realized, oh, I need to assign him chores on the farm.
Yes.
That's it. And that's when things turned around. You know? Yeah, ground me. Go ahead.
Please. Oh, no, don't throw me in that brown patch.
Why don't you ground me to my bedroom? How about that?
You do not come out of there.
Do not come out of the bed. Okay, I'll sit and listen to my stereo.
You go to your room now.
Read my comic books. That'd be fun.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Well, that was a fine little list, I think.
We hope you'd enjoyed another list with Radio from Hell on X90.
Well, Todd had the vinyl, but because on this day in 1993, Depeche Mode released their 8th studio album, Songs of Faith and Devotion, which includes
yes, so many great songs, and it was the album that kind of sort of caused the band to have a lot of trouble during its recording. Alan Wilder, who eventually left the band after the ensuing tour, he was kind of tasked with doing much of the studio work. Dave Gahan started messing around with drugs and really got himself into a bad spot during the tour. So, yeah. But still a fine album.
Mm-hmm. This vinyl's pretty hefty, too.
That's the 180-gram reissue, Carrie.
Oh, that's why.
Because I'm one of those guys.
What does that mean?
It's odd. It's reissued and remastered, and they pressed it on a thicker vinyl instead of the cheap stuff that they used to use, you know, back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
So this is like, you know, for idiots like me that want to throw down $40 for an album that we already have on CD. But right. I want it on vinyl now. So that's,
well, you've got it.
Here we go. Hey. I'm a vinyl hoarder, Bill.
All right.
And by the way, you can hear that sort of stuff every weekday afternoon at 3 o'clock with me, Todd Newcomb. Todd's Turntable.
All right. We got big boy news right now. Then right after that, it's Frank Crist Presents. They're fine. They're just fine. It's our dead celebrity game. I'm going to give you a list of four celebrity names. Three of those celebrities are fine. They're just fine. One of them dead. Pick the dead one correctly. You will win.
For Frank Crist, we're going to be giving away tickets for Newfound Glory. They're showing up on the 22nd of October at the Depot. Those tickets are on sale now. All the concert info at x96.com.
There you go. News now brought to you by, 877-602-9696 to play the game Frank Crist Presents to win those Newfound Glory tickets. News brought to you by
our friends at Utah First Credit Union. They've got the personal checking where every feature comes standard. Learn more at utahfirst.com.
Cillian Murphy, good news, is now confirmed to return to Peaky Blinders. They're going to do a movie, according to the creator, Stephen Knight. The movie is set to begin filming in Digbeth Loch Studios in Birmingham in September and will be set during the Second World War. Speaking to Birmingham World at the premiere of his new BB show, This Town, Stephen Knight confirmed that the Irish actor would reprise his role of the gangster Tommy Shelby. Knight said of Cillian Murphy, he is definitely returning for it. We're shooting it in September, just down the road in Digbeth. The news comes after Murphy shared his enthusiasm for the project earlier this month, telling the Irish Star, "I've always said that if Knight delivers a script that I know he can deliver, because he's such a phenomenal writer, I will be there and play Tommy Shelby again." Murphy did, however, mention that his career may have aged, adding, or his character may have aged. "If we want to watch 50-year-old Tommy Shelby, I'll be there. Let's do that." You didn't watch Peaky Blinders, really?
No,
did you?
No, I didn't.
It was a fascinating series.
Had too many shows.
Yeah, fascinating. Although you need subtitles to watch it. Now, this is a story that we're sort of associated with this murder story here on the Radio from Hell show. Over 5 years after the bodies of a Utah couple were found in the Arizona desert, authorities say that they have finally identified the killer of Jerry and Susan McFalls.
Really?
Yeah. You remember
yes.
Their niece, I believe, called us and talked about this case on the air. It was also featured on one of those unsolved, murder shows on TV.
Mm-hmm. Like Dateline or something like that?
Yeah. Back in January 2018, family members reported that Jerry and Susan McFalls were missing from a home in Littlefield, Arizona. Inside the house, deputies with the Mojave County Sheriff's Office found the couple's phones, money, medications, IDs, along with their pets. I think there was even like cups of coffee had been poured and were sitting on the table. Following a months-long investigation, human remains were found in a shallow grave in the Virgin River Gorge between St. George and Beaver Dam. Susan McFalls was positively identified, her husband not positively identified until some time later, a couple of years later, with the use of DNA analysis. Now, despite the bodies being discovered, law enforcement made no arrests, although people were pretty sure they knew who did it.
Mm-hmm.
Kenneth Gene Snyder. Following interviews, a witness told detectives that he had seen Mr. Snyder shoot and kill the McFalls after a verbal altercation. They were always having property disputes with this guy, I think. He was a strange fellow who, he had fences with skulls on the fence posts and around his property, things like that. Now, this witness claimed that Mr. Snyder first shot Jerry, then shot Susan, and then took their bodies and dumped them in a shallow grave by the Virgin River. According to the sheriff's office, the witness claimed Snyder had threatened them, the witness, if they called law enforcement.
Oh, really?
And that's why they had not spoken up.
Oh.
Through search warrants and new evidence backing up the witness claims, it was announced Thursday that the detectives have determined that Snyder was, in fact, responsible for the death of the McFalls. Now, Snyder, he's not around anymore.
Yeah.
He was shot and killed during a domestic violence incident on June 1st, 2023.
Oh.
So no arrests will be made, but they now know who they're positive
they're
now.
Pretty sure it's him.
They're pretty positive that he did it.
Wow.
And it brings some closure. The McFalls family released the following statement. 2,250 days we struggled through this mess of searching for answers. They finally came. No more waiting. No more persecutions. No more lies. No more wasting valuable resources. No more trials. And no more wondering what happened. Thank you so much to so many who continue to believe in Jerry and I with your love and support and prayers. It's definitely a bittersweet ending. We definitely could not have stayed as strong without all of your support, finally. And we can close this chapter and move on to the next in our lives. Thank you, thank you, thank you. All right. An aircraft landed safely at North Las Vegas Airport after losing a door mid-flight.
Was it a Boeing?
The incident prompted the Federal Aviation Administration to investigate the plane, a single-engine Diamond DA-40. So it's a small plane. Landed safely at 9:20 a.m. After losing the left rear passenger door. There were two people on board of the plane at the time. No one, thankfully, was injured.
Small aircraft, man.
Things are really going to hell in Haiti. I mean, not going. They have gone to hell in Haiti. Haiti is on the brink of collapse as armed gangs lay siege to the capital. But a grisly group of vengeful locals are fighting back.
Really?
Port-au-Prince, a city dubbed the most dangerous city on earth, has just become even deadlier as vigilantes are now hunting down the gangsters, burning and mutilating them.
Oh.
Several gangsters were killed, dismembered, and dragged through the streets and set on fire by citizens in Petionville on Wednesday. The Haitian Vigilante Justice Movement, it's called Bois Calé, appears to be experiencing a resurgence. Bodies are piling up on the streets of Haiti's capital, which is engulfed in an all-out civil war between these warring gangs, a weak police force, and citizen-led death squads. Thousands have been killed this month amid widespread reports of murder, rape, arson, kidnappings, after some 200 merciless gangs who rule the capital streets sparked a new dawn of violence. But the citizens are fighting back against the gangs. The police can't seem to do anything.
Yeah.
Those stories like that, it makes me hate myself just a little bit because here's, you know, that's going on and here's my world. Tomorrow I'm going to go get my hair colored.
Yeah.
I hope she has the right color of blue that I like.
No charges are going to be filed in the death of Nex Benedict, Tulsa County District Attorney Stephen Kunzweiler said on Thursday. Benedict died on February 8th and the medical examiner ruled their death a suicide, a summary report released already. The full report is being released March 27th. Benedict died one day after a fight at Owosso High School. There's been an outcry locally and nationally following their death. Vigils across the globe paid tribute to Nex. The DA's office said in a release the fight started after two groups of students attending in-school suspension antagonized each other in the days leading up to the fight. Kunzweiler said none of the students reported this to the teacher or school administrator. Witnesses said the fight in the bathroom lasted less than a minute after Nex Benedict poured water over two girls after comments were made about how Benedict laughed. And the girls presumably did not care for Nex Benedict being in the girls' bathroom. But Nex Benedict was just trying to live their life and be their authentic self.
Yeah.
And was really not hurting anyone.
No.
Number of abortions performed in the United States last year has gone up since the Supreme Court struck down Roe v. Wade.
Really?
Yep.
So, didn't work, huh?
It might have something to do with the next story I have here, how the unregulated sperm market is creating an online baby boom. I don't know.
Ooh.
And for the first time ever, doctors have successfully transplanted a genetically edited pig kidney into a living human being.
It's a pig man, Jerry.
It's a pig kidney. they say it went well. The patient is doing well. But it was weird. They say that the kidney will probably only be good for 2 years.
Oh, okay.
I saw pig kidney on the Warp Tour a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
All right, that's it. Sports, weather, traffic?
Sports was a bad day for BYU basketball in the NCAA tournament. They got their butts kicked. It was just kind of a heartbreaking loss. Duquesne Beat them 71-67.
So first time Duquesne has been in a tournament, I heard, like since 1965 or something.
I looked up how to pronounce Duquesne yesterday prepping for the show, mm-hmm. and I'm like, oh, it's like Duchesne.
Mm-hmm.
So that made sense to me. Our hope, really, it rests on the Utah Utes women's basketball. They're in the NCAA tournament. They've got a game against South Dakota State Saturday night. The U of U men's team is in the NIT. They beat Irvine earlier in the week, and they've got a game on Sunday night against Iowa. The Jazz lost yesterday. They're going to play Houston tomorrow night. And this is cool. Back in 1984, BYU football won the national championship. And I was, you know, like 14 back then. So that was like, and I was all into BYU football.
Mm-hmm.
I've since changed my ways. Mm-hmm. But anyway, it was cool. They won the 1984 national championship. So they got a number of the old players and coaches from back then. And there's a documentary that BYU TV is going to put out later this year. And they were doing like a Q&A panel like last night.
Has Utah ever won the national championship in football?
And BYU is not going to ever do that again. So. And if you want to be, you start thinking about it now, if you want to be a high school football official, we need you. Email todd@x96.com, and I will get you in touch because, believe it or not, our training will begin in August.
Really?
Yeah. So we're getting there.
All right.
We need officials. Rep.
High school or even Ute Conference, even the youth league. We need officials because sometimes – you have bad experiences and you don't come back.
I'd do it if it wasn't for my bum foot.
All right. Weather, it's nice today, 66, spotty sprinkles. Then tomorrow, forget about the spring we've been having. It's going to get rainy and it's going to be that way like into Thursday. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah, just kind of, yeah. Oh, and did we do traffic? Oh, traffic.
Traffic.
Compared to yesterday, traffic is fine, just fine.
I just retweeted dash cam footage from a cop.
Oh, I saw that.
Regarding yesterday, where the guy, got the guy on camera crossing the other side of the freeway.
Yeah.
And running, you know, they don't have footage of him running into the bus, but they have the footage of him jumping over the embankment.
It's eerie for two reasons.
Yeah.
I drove right through that area yesterday and today. You know, yesterday, like an hour before it happened, coming here, and then today, and you can see the mess. And on that dash cam footage, you see the cop goes past the bus
mm-hmm.
that ends up being hit.
Yeah.
So the cop goes past me, sees this bus, you're like, oh, God. And then, then there's this.
But you don't see a crash or anything.
No, it's not footage of the crash.
The guy is flying up the, like, emergency lane wrong way. It's I don't know what happened, but anyway.
All right. Thank you.
Oh, Frank. Frank Christ is here in the studio.
Oh, hello, everyone.
Did you check on William Shatner before you came over? He's
93 actually,
today.
No, he's fine. He's just fine.
How's his hairpiece?
Oh, it's, you know, he's got one of those new ones.
He didn't check on him, though.
It's surgically installed now.
I need one of them.
Frank Christ has joined us in the studio. He is a Grim Reaper. He's the reaper specifically of the souls of precious, precious celebrities, which breaks his heart if he had one.
Frank,
you can hear him whimper there.
Frank, in your previous life, and I know you're kind of secretive about this, but were you a funeral director by chance?
No, I was not. No, no. A lot of people think that, but no.
Frank is tasked with reaping the souls of the precious celebrities, and he joins us every weekday to play a game we call Frank Chris Presents.
They're fine. They're just fine.
He's given me a list of four actors. I do a little research on them. I show there's one dead actor on this list. The other three are, as he says.
They're fine.
The contestant has to figure out who the dead celebrity is, and who do we have?
Michelle.
Michelle, good morning. How are you?
I'm fine. I'm just fine.
Yes, you are, Michelle. Michelle, if you identify the dead celebrity on this list, you will win Newfound Glory tickets, right, Todd?
Oh, yes, indeed. They're going to be here October 22nd at the Depot. Get the details at x96.com.
All right, Michelle, because it's William Shatner's birthday, I don't know if you'd heard. You didn't know, huh? Well, these four actors have been in movies with William Shatner. Okay, so here we go. Number one on the list, Lawrence Luckinbill, an actor, playwright, and director, most known for writing and starring in one-man shows based on the lives of President Roosevelt, Ernest Hemingway and famous American defense attorney Clarence Darrow. He started his career in early soap operas on TV, like The Secret Storm, which is no longer around. He played Cybok, a renegade Vulcan in Star Trek V, The Final Frontier, starring and directed by William Shatner. Number one, Lawrence Luckinbill. Number two, Sally Kirkland. She was a member of Andy Warhol's The Factory. She appeared in more than 250 film and television productions during her 60-year career. Kirkland had roles in Cold Feet, Best of the Best, JFK, and Bruce Almighty, among many, many others. She appeared with Shatner in Big Bad Mama. Number two, Sally Kirkland. Number three, Patty McCormick. She was a child actress when she appeared in The Bad Seed on Broadway and in the film version, for which she was nominated for an Oscar. She was Helen Keller in the original Playhouse 90 production of The Miracle Worker. She played Jeffrey Tambor's wife in on the show The Ropers, and she was Pat Nixon in Frost Nixon. She's with Shatner in the high school drama The Explosive Generation. Number three, Patty McCormick. And finally on this list, Grace Lee Whitney. Whitney was the original Chicken of the Sea mermaid character. Chicken of the Sea has used the mermaid as its mascot to the present. You know, ask any mermaid you happen to see, what's the best tuna?
The Chicken of the Sea.
Chicken of the Sea. Even Frank knows that. Her movie debut was House of Wax. She was cast as a member of the all-female band in Some Like It Hot. She was in over 100 TV shows, including Star Trek as Yeoman Janice Rand, and that's who she plays in several Star Trek motion pictures with William Shatner. Number four, Grace Lee Whitney. All right, Michelle, which one of those actors is dead?
I think it's the last one.
Grace Lee Whitney? You're right. She died at the age of 85 in 2015. After years of struggling with alcohol, Grace Lee Whitney, Yeoman Rand, got sober and continued to be a Christian evangelical. She continued to be alcohol-free until her death. Congratulations, Michelle. You're going to go see Newfound Glory.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hang on the line. Somebody will tell you what to do.
Oh, Grace Lee Whitney.
Poor Yeoman Rand.
Justice for Janice.
That weird braided basket hair.
You know, there was a cup under that.
Is that how they did that?
Yeah.
You know an awful lot about Grace Lee Whitney.
I know an awful lot about our precious, precious celebrity.
And she was the Chicken of the Sea mermaid. I had no idea.
Has anyone seen Andrew Lloyd Webber?
No.
I'm going to go check on him. And okay. If I accidentally slam the lid of his piano down on his fingers, please forgive me. Goodbye, everybody. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Frank. See you Monday. I hope.
I hope Frank stays the hell away from Susan Ann Sully from the Human League. She's young.
Today?
She's only 60, 61.
Oh,
so.
Okay.
I like my new waivers. We need them around forever. It's a big deal for me. Traffic, according to what I'm seeing so far, nothing really crazy to report like yesterday. We all need a break from yesterday.
All right. KXRK Provo, we're going to take a break. Sean Means will be here to review movies, including the new Ghostbusters movie. On the way, stand by.
X96 is the home.
Get ready for adventure. Get ready to fight fire with fire. Brace for excitement. Have a sick bag ready, because this will be a wild ride. It's another episode of Be Gina. I'm Johnny Ola, and moms know that all it takes for a nutritious dinner meal or some crisp greens for a salad and a can of Burns brand Spork.
What? Ooh.
It's summer's time's tastiest combination. Every housewife knows a dozen ways to serve Spork. Ooh. It's the meat for modern meal making.
Ooh.
Quick. Tasty, satisfying. Everyone relishes this savory, satisfying meat of many uses. Cold or hot, Spork, it's the spot.
What is
it? It's sugar-based, tenderized, and ready for a snack or a full-course meal. Keep a few tins of Spork handy. Or try Burns Spief, the companion meat to Spork. Yes, delightful Spief loaf, garnished with cloves and sweet glaze. Served with sweet potatoes and peas, and your family will want second helpings every time.
Every time.
Vary your meals with all of the tasty Burns canned meats.
Burns wieners and beans, Burns steak and kidney, Burns campfire sausage, and so many more.
What
Burns spork and speef. And now, here's the man who makes me crave a second helping, your host, Kerry Jackson.
Ask for the combo can, Johnny.
No kidding.
And what kind of meat is it? I want to know.
Gina, have you ever heard of spam? Mm.
Okay.
It would be sort of like spam.
Okay.
It's like that.
Sporf.
Story. Guy in
pork.
The chat. Guy in the chat room found a photo reference for you. Don't look too closely at that because it's time to play Beat Gina.
Oh, okay.
You can take a look at that later.
All right.
The randomizer has found us a contestant, Katie. Is that right?
Yes, Lindsay.
Lindsay is who you'll be playing against today, Gina.
Hi, Lindsay.
Hi, Lindsay.
Hello.
All right, Lindsay, the prize today is what?
Offspring tickets. They're coming to town with Sum 41 and Simple Plan August 3rd at USANA.
Now, that's if you beat Gina, but if she beats you, what are you prepared to do in her name?
I'm going to donate $100 to the Humane Society.
Great
wow.
idea.
$100. Okay, well, let's toss a coin to see who goes first. It will give you an advantage, Lindsay. Heads or tails, call it.
Heads.
All right. Coin toss app says heads, Gina, as
oh,
you can see.
Lindsay, you're one step closer to winning those offspring tickets.
All right.
I think
so
we
Lindsay,
should throw in a can of speef.
A can of speef as well. A mug of speef.
Mm.
Let's see. We've got it's board game trivia, Lindsay. You'll get the first question. It's board game trivia because Battleship, the movie, was released on this day in 2012. But it was just an excuse to do board game trivia. All right, first question for Lindsay. In the game of life, I think we've all played that. What are the purple cards? What do they represent, the purple cards? Is it one, you're officially diagnosed with depression for having quintuplets? Two, stocks. Mm. Three, salary. Or four, painful rectal itch.
I'm gonna go with two.
Stock is correct.
All right, that's 1 point for Lindsay. Now Gina's turn.
Gina?
Yes.
Jenga.
Okay.
The game Jenga. That is a Swahili word meaning what? Is it one, build,
mm-hmm.
two, tower,
mm-hmm.
three, stupid game, or four, painful rectal itch?
Tower.
You'd like to think that.
No,
no, I'm terribly sorry.
It's a good opportunity for you, Lindsay.
Can I get the answers again?
One is build.
You know, the entire population of the city of Draper is so excited that Sean Means is going to talk about the Ghostbusters movie. So, Draper, pay attention.
All right. Sean Means, brought to you by the sponsored feature.
No.
Should be. All
is
right.
It?
Fine.
Yeah, I would think.
Never mind.
Well,
it's,
if
it's
it
not,
is.
It's okay.
Okay. Here he is, Sean Patrick Means. He is from the, he's from Washington, but he works at the Salt Lake Tribune as a culture editor, sltrib.com, and he's also a movie reviewer. You can find his reviews here on the radio and at moviecricket.net, a whole cache of them, I would assume.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Nice to see you, Sean. Let's get right to it.
Okay, well, we've got four movies to talk about, but three I actually saw. I didn't get to see Immaculate. That is Sydney Sweeney as a nun.
Yes.
That's the one she's been promoting heavily, so and it's horror and stuff. I did not get a chance, unfortunately.
Okay.
We will talk first about Ghostbusters Frozen Empire. This is the fifth movie in the Ghostbusters franchise.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I have to say, I've only found two of them really good, and one of those I'm apparently not supposed to like or even remember.
I'll remember it for you. Yeah. It was the all-girl one, it was really good.
It's the one with the girls. Yeah.
Why are you not supposed to?
Oh, because the fan base has decided it ruined their childhood or something or other.
Worst Ghostbusters ever.
Yeah.
I thought it was funny.
I thought it was hilarious.
And all of them, they were all great.
Yeah. Okay, so this one picks up right after Ghostbusters Afterlife, which was the last one, right?
Yes.
Which introduced us to the grandchildren of the late Egon Spengler, the brainiest of the original
mm-hmm. okay.
Ghostbusters. They've moved to New York, of course, because that's where the ghosts are, and that's where the firehouse is, because we have to have the firehouse. That was the original headquarters for the Ghostbusters. The team is the kids, Trevor, played by Finn Wolfhard, and Phoebe, played by McKenna Grace, who's the brainiest of the current group, along with their mom, Callie, played by Carrie Coon, and their old science teacher, Gary, played by Paul Rudd. And Gary is dating Callie now.
All right. It's official.
It's official. Right. And there's a lot of back and forth about whether he can be considered a stepdad now or not. And it's awkward.
Okay.
That's what passes for humor here. The new Ghostbusters are getting support from the old crew. Winston Zeddemore, Ernie Hudson is their benefactor. He's super rich.
How's he holding up?
He's looking good.
Yeah.
He's looking good. His assistant is Janine. Mm-hmm. Annie Potts, she's back.
She's okay.
She's fine.
All right.
And we have Dan Aykroyd, who's not looking quite so good, but he's getting up there. And eventually, and it takes forever to get to Bill Murray.
Yeah,
he's
like the other one.
You're lucky you showed up at all.
Well, there's that. He's like two scenes basically. Mm-hmm. So far,
I'm on board.
Okay, well, and a lot of characters are back from Afterlife. Which you have to be reminded that that's who they are and what they're there for. The other returning character is Walter Peck.
Oh.
Who's that?
This man has no dick.
This was the guy that used to work for the EPA, was trying to shut down the Ghostbusters.
Yes.
Now who played him?
William Atherton, who was the guy in Die Hard that Bonnie Bedelia punches at the end.
Spoiler. Yeah, I know who William is.
Oh, yeah, the reporter. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so now he's the mayor of New York.
Oh no.
And I think to myself, how does somebody that unlikable get elected mayor of New York? But then I remember Giuliani was mayor for a long time.
True.
So yeah.
And the new guy is not very well liked.
No, do not like.
And so once again he's back trying to bust the ghost get mm-hmm. the Ghostbusters shut down.
Mm-hmm.
Much of the story here revolves around Phoebe, who at 15 is told she's not allowed to be a Ghostbuster because of child labor laws. Which the thing is, she's the best one. So
yeah.
it's hard for her, and she's all the most dedicated. So, but she winds up befriending a teenage ghost.
It's at work, you meet people.
It's a thing. The reason I'm hesitant about talking about what's happening in the movie is because it takes forever for anything to happen in the movie.
Oh, no.
I got so bored. It's an hour before you get to Bill Murray. It's an hour and a half before you get to the big bad.
Yeah.
You know, the final boss level.
So it's all just set up?
It's all just set up. And I refer to this as callbacks to the movie. This is, who are you going to call back is essentially what's going on here.
Callbackers.
The one good part is McKenna Grace as Phoebe. She's...
Oh yeah.
Yeah, she's the only thing that's fresh and interesting.
She was the best part of Afterlife.
It feels like there's a conference room somewhere in Hollywood where they all decided that referencing the old movies is the same thing as telling an actual story. I was bored out of my skull on this movie.
Wow. Okay.
1.5 stars.
1.5 for Frozen Empire.
It's in theaters, just follow the people who are wearing the khaki jumpsuits.
That's true.
Yeah. All right. Now what do we got next?
Problemista. This is a movie that is too whimsical for its own good. It's directed by a first-time director, Julio Torres. He's a former Saturday Night Live writer. He wrote, directed, and he stars as Alejandro. He's a Salvadoran immigrant in New York who wants to be a toy designer. And his toys look like outtakes from a Demetri Martin sketch. he loses his job in New York, where he was monitoring an artist who's in a cryogenic chamber. And without the job, he has 30 days to find a new sponsor so he can keep his visa. Or he has to move back to El Salvador. His best hope is the frozen artist's wife, the super demanding art critic played by Tilda Swinton. Alejandro tries to help the critic, but when one problem is solved, two more take its place. Her nickname is the Hydra.
Ah.
It's like she can be complaining about one thing. If you fix that, then two more things pop up. The problem with the Problemista for me was that it's like many movies made by first-time directors where they try to stuff every idea they've ever had into one movie because they don't think they're going to be able to make a second movie.
Ah, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see that.
I said in the review that this is what you would get if Wes Anderson were a gay Salvadoran who had about $1.50 to spend.
Yeah,
but you got Tilda Swinton.
Yeah, you got, and that's the best part. Tilda is the best part, and I mean, how many times have we said that over the years?
Well,
really?
It's because she can do anything.
She can do anything.
She's really funny and a little tragic. It's a great roll. Two and a half for Problemista.
Well, then let's get to the one I'm really curious about, Late Night with the Devil.
This is for Katie, I think. This is her movie. Late Night with the Devil, it's kind of a found footage horror movie. We're told that we're watching a tape of a transmission of a live talk show from 1977. And it looks very authentic. It looks like an old Johnny Carson kind of thing. And they really get the look down really well.
The clothes and the style and the
obnoxious sidekick, who, you know, the sycophant sidekick and so on. The host, Jack Del Roy, he's seen his ratings in free fall. He's trying to goose his ratings on Halloween. He wants to get up to Carson's ratings, right?
Okay.
And with some tabloid, he wants some tabloid grabbing stuff. First, he has a mentalist on who does his bit. And then he has this magician turned skeptic who aims to prove that the psychic is a fraud. And Carson used to actually do that.
The Amazing Randy used to go against the mentalist.
Yuri Geller.
And also what's his name, the Canadian.
There was another one I can't remember. Kreskin.
Kreskin. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Things get a little weird when the mentalist feels some evil vibrations somewhere in the studio, and then we get to the main event. Jack has been dating a parapsychologist, we find out.
Mm-hmm.
And the parapsychologist she brings in a patient who's a 13-year-old girl who grew up with a devil-worshipping group who all died in a house fire.
Oh,
okay.
That's the setup. That's,
yeah.
You know,
there you go.
You buy the premise, you buy the bit, as Carson used to say.
I already want to go to this one instead.
She may be carrying a demon.
Maybe.
Maybe. Mm-hmm. And you don't know what's happening.
Oh, so
wouldn't that be wacky?
This is directed and written by these two brothers, the Cairns brothers. I've never heard of them before. They're new. They're good. And you want to, it's like, okay, I want to know what the next thing these guys do, because they obviously are really good at what they're doing.
Yeah.
They get the atmosphere right. It really does feel like, you know, old 70s kind of
thing. Cool.
And then when it flips over into full horror, it is just terrifying. It's really good.
Really?
The best part, the guy playing the host, Jack, the actor is David Dastmalchian.
I know who he is because my kid is fallen in love with Gotham.
Mm-hmm.
And he plays essentially the Penguin.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. He's good. He's real over the top in Gotham.
Yeah.
He's good.
You've seen him in a lot of things. He was in the Ant-Man movies. He was one of the guy in the group. Mm-hmm. He was in Suicide Squad. He was in the first part of Dune.
Yeah.
He was in Oppenheimer somewhere. I can't
remember. Oh, yes, he was. Yeah.
So he's one of those guys you recognize him when you see him. And here he just owns it. He has this genuine attitude of the smarmy Hollywood, you know, player trying to and then facing dark eternity, which is just, you know, it's really great performance. 3 stars for Late Night with the Devil. It's playing at a few theaters around town starting today, and then it'll be streaming on Shudder starting on April 19th. If you don't want to be caught, you know, screaming in agony in public.
It really is frightening.
It's really scary.
How tough, which the theater's like, is this like a really limited release?
No, it's in about 6 or 7 around. You'll be able to find it.
All right.
The guy you're thinking of is Robin Lord Taylor in Gotham playing the Penguin.
Well, he's, okay.
Yeah. He looks like it. They look alike.
But he has been in Gotham. I just looked up his...
Yeah, he did a stint in Gotham.
In the Suicide Squad, he was Polka Dot Man. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But 3 stars.
Mm-hmm.
Good. I'm excited about this. This is going to be good. What's next week?
Next week, we have Godzilla X Kong and the New Empire.
It's the Mighty Monster team up.
It's the Mighty Monster team up.
he's got a robot hand.
That's the big thing.
That's cool.
Yeah.
They haven't told me if I'm going to see it.
Oh.
So
I think you'd know by now.
I would hope to have known by now.
They need to just let...
I've asked.
Then you just need to let Toho take over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And just not let...
Do -1 again and do that.
Yeah.
That'd be perfect.
All right. MovieCricket.net, sltrib.com, Sean Means. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Traffic, Todd.
Traffic so far, not as bad as yesterday. Just a few standard delays. I mean, really, we're good. And it is brought to you by nothing.
All right. Boner today, brought to you by.
We've got these boner candidates here that you'll be voting on. Number one, again with the honking and the shooting. Number two, $5,000 for two of them? That's a bargain. And boner candidate number three, they spelled out a racial slur with crackers.
Oh, all right, boner of the day, big boy news, all coming up after these messages and a song. Stand by. Let me go get the stack of CDs.
There's a Radio from Hell Classics. We've kind of shied away from doing many phone bits for until we get our phones fixed, because those beeping noises are just driving.
Even though every program expert in the world says we should do phones.
Well, and our program experts tell us, you guys do phones really well. That's why you should do it, a lot of it.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, I agree. I think we do a really good job at interacting with the audience on the phone. But, you know, it's pretty hard to do when it's going beep.
Yep.
Beep.
Can we get a tin can system set up?
That's been discussed.
Genuinely?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, sure. All it takes is a little, you know.
No, we just talk to people out on the street.
Yeah.
You know, they come up to the side of the building and pick up the tin can and. This is how you interact with Radio from Hell.
You're joking, but I kind of love that.
we tried to do something similar to that once. Well, it's not similar, but it was an idea of how to interact with the audience with CB radios. So remember, we got a CB radio and we put it in the studio, we thought we would contact people on the CB mm-hmm. and interact with them over the air while we were on the CB, and I
didn't work.
Nobody ever seemed to. It was past the time that people had CB radios much.
I'd imagine you'd have to keep your hand hovering the sensor button a lot for that.
That was the other problem we ran into, is that people were swearing on the CB.
Yeah.
Even though you weren't supposed to, there was no way to stop them.
So what'd you find over there?
Well,
in that dusty stack of wax.
How do you feel about Little Tommy Little?
I remember these.
He was a child stand-up comic.
Little Tommy Little, the 3-year-old or 5-year-old stand-up comic. Yeah, I think it introduces him, I think.
Please.
Let's see.
I don't remember.
Let's see if this works.
And so the guy says, never mind that, some guy in there is throwing out ears of buttered corn. Jeepers, what are you, an audience or an oil painting? But seriously, folks, Wink, our MC here at Zany's, handed me a note before I came out on stage, and it says that someone in the audience is celebrating a special day. Is Steven Peterson in the audience?
Right here, Sonny.
Well, I got a song to sing for you on your special day. Here we go. Happy poop day to you. You live in a zoo. You look like a monkey, and you poop like one, too. poo-poo pee-pee.
That's kind of high concept stuff. High concept stuff. He would always, little Tommy Little would always sign off with.
That was his line. You know, he always knew he could go to that line to get a laugh.
Poo-poo pee-pee.
Because it worked in the schoolyard and it.
Yeah.
Worked in the clubs, too.
High concept.
High concept comedy. Yeah.
That's highfalutin stuff there.
You know what I'd like to hear if we dig the casino one we did? The Deseret.
Oh, I love that one. Yeah. We need to find that one.
Yeah, the Deseret.
The Deseret Inn.
The Deseret Inn Hotel and Casino.
Which was a Mormon-themed casino.
A gambling casino. Was it in Winnemucca or something?
See, the Deseret Inn.
Yeah. Okay.
Because there was a desert in. This was the Deseret.
I see. Yeah. I see.
That's where
my confusion lies.
Did you know that the state of Utah used to be called Deseret?
Yes.
Okay.
I did know that.
There you go.
Yeah.
You got another one there?
Well, I could pull out a.
What? What is it? I hope it's another high concept bit.
Please,
like Little Tommy Little.
I enjoyed that, but your use of high concept tells a lot about your feelings.
Want to hear Tales from the Grave?
I don't remember Tales from the Grave. So
it was just Tales of the Crypt. Tales from the Crypt. Apparently.
Sure.
All right. So there'll be a crypt keeper, but it'd be a grave keeper, I guess.
Greetings, children. This is your old friend, the Grave Digger. Today I have a frightening little yarn that has all the ingredients need to make you shudder. Sex, violence, lawyers, and three exploding human heads. Oh, this tale is called There She Blows, and we'll take you now to the law offices of Parker, Jameson, and Osborne, attorneys at law.
Mr. Parker?
Mr. Osborne.
Parker, your fly is undone.
Oh? Oh, so it is. I was just having sex with my secretary.
But, Mr. Parker, that is so wrong. You're a married man.
I'm aware of that, Osborne, and I don't care. As a matter of fact, I'm going back in for seconds.
Parker, your head is getting bigger. It's... Oh, my God. Look at all the blood.
What's all the racket in here?
Parker's head just exploded.
Good Lord, what a mess. Hey, what's Parker clutching in his still twitching hand?
That's the Bonneville specific file. He's been working overtime to make the board of directors look better in court. I believe he just finished it. Jameson, what are you doing?
Erasing Parker's name and putting mine on it. I'll take all the credit now that he's dead.
Now Jameson's head has exploded too. I'd better call for help. But first, I'm going to go through their wallets and steal all the money. They're not going to need it, and no one will ever know.
Those three really know how to get ahead, eh? Their law firm tried to expand too rapidly and suddenly went bust. Well, in case you hadn't figured out the moral of the story, it's... if you're a lawyer and you do something bad, your head will explode. This is the old gravedigger inviting you to join me next time when our story will be called Chop Chop, Who's There? On Tales from the Grave.
Good Lord, what a mess. Once again, high concept comedy.
Because see, the plot of the show was... Mm-hmm. People do bad things, and then they pay for it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You know, that was every week.
Every week, that was the plot of the show.
Yeah, the highbrow motif of heads exploding was definitely ahead of its time.
Yeah, I had to take a blown-up balloon and twist it to make the expanding head sound.
When would this play in your show?
During the show.
Yeah.
I don't know. We played a lot of records.
Okay.
We played a lot of songs, like... Did you get your six songs an hour in there? Did you get your nine songs? which we kept continually trying to whittle down the number of songs we played so we could do more stupid stuff, high concept stuff.
I mean, like that.
You know. But would you come on and talk afterwards, or would there be a commercial break buffering?
Or sometimes it would go right to break.
Okay. I love it.
We would introduce the bid. And
it's embarrassing. All right. there you go. Okay, well, we will take a break.
I miss all that. I love doing all that after.
Thank you. You say it's embarrassing. You're the one putting it on. Yeah. I love it.
Good Lord, what a mess. And
all right. In 1990, Nine Inch Nails released Head Like a Hole, the second single from their debut album, Pretty Hate Machine.
I'm trying to remember what the first single
was. It was Down In It.
Was it Down In It?
Down In It was one. And I remember hearing...
we played that.
Yeah, I remember hearing that album for the first time and just blew my mind. The production, the edge that he had to it, and it was kind of a precursor for, you know, grunge, because... You know, we were in the world of playing songs by Anything Box, and you know, and it was very poppy. And then this comes along, and still very electronic and Depeche Mode-ish, but a little sharper.
Flashback to that day, if the ghost of Carrie Jackson appeared, time traveling Carrie Jackson, and said that fellow is going to win an Academy Award, you wouldn't have believed me.
No,
you were right.
Yeah. Let's see, 7:26. Let's begin with Boner of the Day. Three news stories. These are examples of bad, stupid, or funny human behavior. You will decide with your vote of these three candidates which one is the worst, which one deserves to be Boner of the Day for today, March 22, 2024. We'll give you two candidates now, a third after the news, and once you've heard all three, you will vote. One of you lucky random boner voters will receive...
We got concert tickets. Stained and Breaking Benjamin going to be at the Utah First Credit Union Amphitheater on the 5th of October. And you can get the details at x96.com.
Is that right?
Mm.
Okay.
All right. Here's boner candidate number one. Again with the honking of the shooting. Remember, we had a boner candidate like this earlier in the week. Mm. A 17-year-old girl had the scare of her life when somebody shot at her for honking at a driver who cut her off while driving on an Indiana interstate. The girl, according to the Indiana State Police, was driving on I-465 when somebody cut her off, and as a natural reaction, she honked her horn, like that, just in fright more than anything. Police say that soon after, someone in the other vehicle fired multiple shots into her car. They went through the windshield, including one that went through the driver's seat. While police did not disclose the young lady's name, they did say she was not injured during the shooting. In a social media post, state police reminded drivers to call 911 immediately if they get shot at. Road rage out on the interstate. Officials say crime scene investigators took the girl's car for evidence, and detectives are still investigating the crime. I saw pictures of the windshield, bullet holes through it.
I can't remember who it was I was talking to, this person who said she loves her car horn. She uses her car horn. I said, don't. You don't know who you're honking at. There's all kinds of crazy out there.
I understand. Like, this was probably almost an involuntary thing, you know. It's just like, but, yeah, don't just honk out of anger.
I was teaching my now 16-year-old licensed nephew how to drive, you know, a year ago. And one of the first things I told him is, like, you're in your car, someone's going to do something stupid, and you're going to want to honk or give him the finger. Never, ever, ever, because crazy.
Yeah.
All right, here's boner candidate number two. $5,000 for two of them? Well, that's a bargain. A Kentucky mom and dad are arrested for... trying to sell their newborn twin daughters for $5,000.
Only $5,000?
Wow.
It's a bargain. According to an arrest citation, Zachary Davis and Jacqueline Keith are both charged with promoting human trafficking after a relative contacted police regarding the alleged sale. The arrest citation states that after responding to the home and interviewing the parents, Mr. Davis admitted to saying that, I said I'd sell the twins, but, you know, I was just joking. I was just joking because, you see, I thought my relatives were going to try and take them away regardless. They were trying to take them away from me. So I just said, well, I'll sell them to you if you want them that bad. According to the arrest citation, Davis told police he believed the relative had been watching the newborns for around 3 weeks and would always talk to him about letting them keep the twins rather than taking them home.
Probably a good idea.
Well, okay then. Well, I'll just sell the both of them to you for $5,000. How's that?
He's all smiles, too, in the mugshot on x96.com/live.
He's a sweet-looking guy.
The mugshot. He's hey.
That's a bargain, $5,000.
Parents of the year.
Coming up in a moment, boner candidate number three, they spelled out a racial slur with crackers, the soda variety.
Thank you.
I screwed up. The prize for voting for the boner is a boner T-shirt that you have to win.
Mm-hmm.
The tickets will be for boner recap later today.
Okay.
So the boner T-shirt if you want to vote when we start voting later.
And also don't forget, before we get to news, boner candidate number three coming up as well. Best question of the week. We'll be doing that right after we award the boner of the day, so send that to radiofromhell@x96.com. News brought to you by
our friends at Knaff's Knives. They've got knives. They want their pocket knives in your pocket. Visit their store in Clearfield where they offer knife sharpening and engraving, or visit them at knaffs.com/X96. You can see products and use the code X96 for 20% off. That's knaffs.com/X96. And I understand they are friends of X96 and they listen to us all day long, and they're local and we love them. So go there.
Indeed.
On a new episode of Hot Ones, Gwyneth Paltrow, 51 years old now, revealed that she had a babysitter that was just awesome when she was a kid. It was Kiefer Sutherland.
Oh, it's our buddy Kiefer.
Yeah. Isn't that cool, she said. I was at the Williamstown Theater Festival where my mom, who's an actress, Blythe Danner, was doing some plays, and he was an apprentice there at the theater festival, and he babysat me and my brother Jake, and he was just awesome. She raved about the now famous Kiefer Sutherland, who's 57 and who is the son, of course, of Donald Sutherland and Shirley Douglas. Sutherland has discussed babysitting Paltrow himself, like in a 2009 interview when he said, "I was working at a theater with Gwyneth's mother, and I believe on a couple of occasions I was asked to look after her for an hour or two. I think it was very funny because it's unbelievable how fast someone goes from 13 to 18, and obviously they look a lot different that, and when Gwyneth started to work, I thought, well, that must be another girl because I always remember her being 11 or 12 years old. That can't be that girl I babysat."
I had the weirdest experience with Kiefer Sutherland that I can't believe happened, but there was, for a minute, he was trying to start his own record label, and it was subsidized through one of the major labels, and so he comes to town. We had him on your show the next day, but the night before, I go to dinner. My wife and I go to dinner with Kiefer Sutherland over at the Monaco, and we just kind of sat in this back private room.
How much did he drink?
Oh, my God. I've never seen that much whiskey go into a human being.
Yeah.
And he just was fine. I mean, I don't know how he does that, but it was a lot.
And you know how he does it. His father's Donald Sutherland.
Well, exactly. Yeah, that's in the family. Yeah. Like, he was nothing but charming, just the sweetest, coolest
dude.
Yeah,
he was very nice when he was on our show.
Yeah.
Police on Thursday arrested an Idaho prison gang member and an accomplice who escaped following an attack on corrections officers at a Boise hospital, with investigators looking into whether they committed two killings while on the run. Two more murders. Skylar Mead, the escaped inmate and white supremacist, and Nicholas Umpfnauer, the man who police say shot two Idaho corrections officers early Wednesday to break Mead out of custody, were arrested at a traffic stop Thursday afternoon in Twin Falls. Authorities said during a news conference that they were investigating two homicides in Nez Perce and Clearwater counties, where the 2020 Honda Civic the duo were seen fleeing in was later found. Police found shackles at the scene of one of the killings, and that's one of the ways we tied them together, Idaho State Police said. So they think that they killed two other people in the short time they were on the run.
Wow.
A third teenager has been arrested in the death of a Taylorsville man who was allegedly abducted before being shot and left in a remote area of Utah County. The body of 21-year-old Alex Franco was discovered in the West Desert near Lehi 2 days after police put out a public call to locate him. The third teenager involved in the case, who was only identified as a 17-year-old boy, was taken into custody early Thursday morning. They believe that this was all over a gun deal gone bad, buying, selling gun, I don't know. But, yeah. Let's see. A firefighter in Pennsylvania was extradited to Utah and appeared in court on Monday. The firefighter is accused of preying on two girls in Utah through social media. The North Park Police Department's case against 31-year-old Daniel Roy Cromer, Jr., includes several allegations about his contact with two 11-year-old girls from North Logan. And this is a guy who's a firefighter in Pennsylvania, so he was doing this online. And a Wasatch County Sheriff's Office employee has been arrested for alleged sexual crimes involving a minor. Michael McKee, Administrative Services Director for Wasatch County Sheriff's, was arrested Wednesday for investigation of human trafficking of a child. Heber City Police stopped the car, and the adult driver admitted that the 15-year-old juvenile in the passenger seat was with him for the purpose of sex. That's what he said.
He just...
Yeah. Yeah.
What's this guy's what's this guy's drag name? Does he have a...
He's not a drag
performer.
Not a drag queen? No, he works for the Wasatch County Sheriff's Office.
Wow.
And the juvenile was promised nicotine vape pens in exchange for sex with the adult, the affidavit claims. Donald Trump is already moaning and whining that the election this year will be rigged.
Well, yeah.
It's going to be rigged. It's already it's rigged. And then evangelicals, they're coming out in force for Donald Trump, saying God gave us Donald Trump.
God needs to make better choices.
Wait, yeah, so God picked the guy mm-hmm. who, while his wife was having a baby,
right,
had sex with a porn star.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. then later paid her off
yeah.
to be quiet. That's
right.
That's God's
yeah.
choice
yeah,
there.
Because God, and that God allowed that to happen because he knew that Trump would be the one to lead us to glory.
What glory?
I don't know. A glory hole, more like
yes, yes.
And tech billionaire couple Matthew and Tatiana Prince, the ones with
the
Park
house,
City house.
Park City, yeah.
Gerke talked about this yesterday. And they have, in fact, filed a lawsuit against their Park City neighbors, saying that they can't go outside for fear of the large, vicious, aggressive dogs that they their neighbors have. Okay, fine. And finally this. On Wednesday, the beloved cookie company, Nabisco,
yes,
who produces Oreos,
mm-hmm.
has announced that Churro Oreos
Ooh.
Will be available nationwide at the end of March. Churro Oreos sandwich, churro-flavored cream between fried dough-flavored golden cookies.
What?
The cinnamon sugar cookies are coming to grocery stores on March 27th. This isn't the first time they've been on the shelves. The snack brand introduced churro-flavored cookies in 2019 as mm-hmm. a mystery flavor
yes.
Oreo. At that time, the cookies were packaged with an ambiguous white label and looked identical to regular Oreos with chocolate-covered cookies. But now they're mm-hmm. going to bring them out, and there you go.
Delicious.
That's it.
Let's see. Weather traffic.
Weather going to be spotty sprinkles and then rain starting tomorrow and lasting into several days. Weather brought to you by Dr. Cobble's Aesthetics Team. They're focused on three skin therapy devices for younger and healthier skin. See for yourself at their Aesthetics Open House, 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. This will be on Thursday, April 4th, 9355 South 13th East in Sandy. Traffic looking a hell of a lot better than yesterday. It was not a good day at all. Just your usual backups so far and nothing of major importance that I'm seeing. However, if you see it, say something, Infiniteam traffic members. When it's safe to do so, text us at 33986 because I'm half-assing my traffic reports and I rely thoroughly on you to do my job. I'm covering for Gina. That's the thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, half-ass it. here's boner candidate number three. They spelled out a racial slur with crackers. A Saratoga Springs family wants more done after their son was a victim of racist acts while he was at a convention with a high school group. Deacon Burton returned to his hotel room last week after a long day at an FFA convention in Logan. I think that's the Future Farmers of America.
Mm-hmm.
He was with his fellow Westlake High School students at this convention. But instead of finding fresh linens in his room, he came back to a confusing scene. I see soap smushed into the floor, crackers everywhere, pillows, sheets, the entire mattress ripped off the bed. The ironing table was in the bathroom. Our room was absolutely trashed, and on top of it, there was an N-I-G wrote out in crackers, he said. And there's a picture of, you can't really see, but there's some crackers and stuff on that little table there
yeah.
in that picture. Now, it doesn't say in this article, but I'm assuming that Mr. Deacon Burton is a young gentleman of color. He admits that those in the FFA like to prank each other, but he says what he found went too far. I wonder just why. There's no reason. Deacon's parents are sharing the same sentiment as their son. You can't use ignorance, and you can't use it as a joke, or we're just pranking them. That can't be the excuse. Ignorance isn't an excuse, said Deacon's father, Troy. The Burtons wish that they were made aware of the incident from the school or the teachers, but they found out about it when another parent told them about it. Even after talking to officials while picking up their son from school, nothing was mentioned to them about it. Mm. Both of his FFA advisors came up to my truck, and they were talking, and they were mentioning how much they love Deacon, and he should be maybe apply for a leadership position next year, but they didn't say anything about this incident. In a statement about the incident, the Alpine School District said they've opened up an investigation after the Burtons issued a complaint. I'm appalled, said Charlie Burton. How many stories I've heard over the last 2 days similar to this one. My kids hear that N-word all day, every day at school. It just needs to stop. The Burtons say, and you know, you shouldn't have to do that. I mean, yeah. The Burtons say, can you not educate your kids about why it's inappropriate to say the N-word? Can you imagine? Boner candidate number three, they spelled out a racial slur in crackers.
All right, so let's review the first two and vote.
Boner candidate number one, again with the honking and the shooting, multiple shots fired through a windshield of a young woman's car because she honked at somebody who cut her off in traffic. Boner candidate number two, $5,000 for two of them, that's a bargain. A Kentucky mom and a dad arrested for allegedly trying to sell their newborn twin daughters for $5,000. And boner candidate number three, they spelled out a racial slur with crackers.
All right. Let's get to voting. Boner of the day. One, two, or three, remember your candidate number, the one that you think should win. Which one of these three candidates is the worst? Which one should be boner of the day? One, two, or three, put that single digit in the message of a text and text that to 33986. Or you can call Katie in the producer's booth at 877-602-9696. Use your voice to vote. Or go online, x96.com. Look for the box that says Boner of the Day, March 22, 2024. Click and vote. And if you don't see that box, refresh your internet browser. Click and vote. We're going to award the boner right after these messages. You got 4 minutes to get your vote in. And then it's best question of the week. If you hurry, you can get that one in, too. RadioFromHell@x96.com is the email. Have another drink with Jimmy the Wine Guy at 8 o'clock. Beat Gina coming up as well. Well, it's Beat Todd today.
Is it Shatner trivia?
It is Shatner trivia. No Star Trek, though.
Okay, cool.
All right. I don't know if that's easier or not.
I'll do my best.
Yeah, right. Well, there's a little Star Trek. Okay, I like a little. All right, get to voting. Here we go. 4 minutes. Boner of the day.
We got into a discussion of skincare with Gina Barbera.
Oh, yes.
And we're talking about lashes. And somebody has reached out about this. Two people have, as a matter of fact, who want to give you some advice, Gina, and then one person needs your advice.
Wonderful.
So this one says, hi, Gina, please remain seated.
Oh, sorry.
If you have questions about caring for your lash extensions, please contact me.
Oh.
It's always been an issue for me to hear about women who are not taught how to care for their lashes after they got home. A good lash stylist will ensure that you know how to care for them.
Yes.
Lash extensions can get wet, contrary to the rumor mill.
Out on the corner. Yeah. You'll see a group of people whispering.
Yeah. Water will not affect your lashes in any way.
Let's not tell her that.
And they should be washed daily. It's true that oils can affect the bond of some adhesives, resulting in loss. However, by keeping your lashes clean, you will extend the life of the extensions, and more importantly, prevent eye infection.
Oh, yeah, I don't want that.
Then she goes on to say, I would recommend a soft brush, gentle cleanser, so forth and so on. I guess she's in the business. This woman is in the business.
To defend my lash stylist, she did give me a lash wash.
Oh, okay.
And brush.
All right. This woman says, we've been selling our brand to professionals for 15 years and so on.
Yeah.
Here's wishing you years of beauty simplified.
It is beauty simplified.
Make mine a double. Please pass this info on to the beautiful Sue Jackson, a BFOP since Bill's early A.M. Ogden days.
Wow.
Jamie Kelly.
Thanks, Jamie.
Now, Sue is weighing in. You're supposed to keep the lashes dry for at least the first 48 hours.
Right. Mm.
That's the thing.
Yeah, because, it takes for the glue to really cure.
Well, this is good to know because I'm going to get there.
Yeah,
should. Carrie, you and I should both get lash extensions.
Don't need them.
Well, that's nice.
You do have.
Gorgeous.
Yeah, you do have.
But, I'm going to Sue's stylist. She gave me the hookup, and She did a great job, and she did give me good tips and lash cleanser.
And then we had an email last week that says, I need to know Gina's skincare regimen. And we talked about that, and mm-hmm. then we got a follow-up email to that. Gina.
Yes.
What facial oil do you use? I've got to know. My daughter has very sensitive skin. I've got to know.
You're going to hate me.
What? It's more than I do?
It's expensive.
Why would anybody hate you?
Because it's expensive.
Well, but, I mean, you could just use Wesson oil.
No, no.
Olive oil?
No. It's, I'm going to be honest with you. So.
What's it called and how much is it? Jesus,
so I on. I wondered how Liv Tyler got her skin so beautiful. Oh. She has beautiful skin. Yeah. And she has a whole YouTube video about her skin routine.
Mm-hmm.
And she said she uses this skin oil from Sarah Chapman, who is a facialist in England. She's very good.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, well, I want to look like Liv Tyler, mm-hmm. so I'm going to get her. I'm not going to tell you how much
yes,
it is.
Please, tell us. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Now you've got everybody curious. How much is it?
It's like $120.
For how much?
I mean,
2 gallons, 3 gallons?
No, like, you know, that big. I don't,
no, you're, thinking gallons. Of the, you're thinking of the Kirkland.
With a big skip, with a big squirt thing on the top, you know, the pump.
That's the one you're thinking
of. Yeah.
So I splurged and got some, and I really like it.
$120 bucks for how much?
I don't know. How much is that?
It's probably about 3 ounces.
Yeah. Three or 4 ounces, yeah. That's pretty expensive. How long does it last?
It lasts. You only need a little tiny bit.
So it's probably a year. Probably a year's worth, right?
At least half a year.
So it's 6 months worth.
Well, that's couple of drops in your hand, and then how you put it on? This is very specific how you put it on. So you put a couple drops.
Does it
in the
come
palm.
With instructions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a couple drops in the palm of your hand, and then you take your fingertips and you.
At 33986.
All right, 7:47. Let's award boner of the day.
And the boner of the day is brought to you in part by some leftover Spanish chorizo and lentil soup.
And our friends at Gracie's right across the street. They're open daily for lunch and dinner, now serving brunch every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday until 3 p.m. Enjoy Gracie's award-winning heated patio and live music 4 nights a week. Gracie's at the corner of 300 South and West Temple. Got to be 21 or older to enter.
The voting, so again with the honking and the shooting and the hing and the I think people were, well, we already had one like that this week. 16 votes. Boner candidate number 2, selling the babies. That got nearly 100 votes, but it couldn't beat boner candidate number 3. They spelled out a racial slur with crackers with 165 votes. Yep. Boner of the day.
There you go. That's your boner of the day for today, March 22, 2024. Now qualified to be boner of the week, Dave Mattson. Dave the Flower Guy will be here at 9:50 this morning to tell us who boner of the week is.
He never misses.
Never misses. All right.
Oh, I know what that music means.
Mm-hmm.
It means it's time for the best question of the week.
That's the question.
Is it the best question of the week? It's a question. How about that?
It's a couple of questions. Yeah.
We've got them here. We've got one for Todd, actually.
Oh, really?
Oh, no.
This is from our good friend, Cardboard Chris.
Okay.
My question is, hey, Todd. What changes would you like to see happen in refereeing youth sports?
Well,
and then particularly when it comes to unruly parents.
I have some stories to tell there.
How about snipers?
God,
pick them
off. The sad truth is that they have to have police at each site. High school
football games.
Well, okay. So there's two things. So for youth, they just need. You know,
mm-hmm.
more control. I don't do that anymore. I stopped doing youth because it's a lot of work. And
So you're talking about outside of high school, like peewee football and that stuff?
So that's, but they do have to have cops at each site.
Really?
Yeah. And they've been doing some great work there. They've been in, you know, better training for the officials and recruiting and everything. For high school, though, I think right now we have five person officiating crew,
mm-hmm.
and that leaves a couple of blind spots in everybody that officiates high school football, even the bosses who would love to do this. They just don't have the funding to do it because you'd have to hire two more officials per game. But we need to have a seven-person crew to have the positions that we call the deep wing. So you'd have deeper sideline coverage, like farther down the field from the line of scrimmage.
How does this help?
So I'm confusing things.
Yes,
that would just help the game. But unruly parents, they just, you know, I think unruly parents should have to come and be officials. Sign them up. Come and see what it's like. Mm. Learn the rules.
I think it'd be great if you could if a parent is unruly, you could throw the kid out of the game.
You can, and we do.
And you do?
Yeah, you can.
Because your parent is unruly?
We can throw the parents. That doesn't happen. I don't know how the youth leagues handle that, but I know you can remove. Like, I've thrown parents out of the top row of stands at Bonneville High School before.
Hmm.
So how do you throw them out? Do you have to go up and get them yourself?
Yes. No. I do. I strong-arm them right out of the building. No, you just game administration and security and police, and they take care of that. Mm. They have now made it mandatory after an incident that I was involved in last year where they will – and they've kind of always sort of done this in places, but now it's kind of become the way it has to be. Police must escort us off of the field into our locker room.
Because you were threatened with violence.
I was spat upon and had things thrown at me.
Mm.
Oh,
on my way out of a football game.
It's high school football. Yeah.
People.
But they are the High School Activities Association took care of that. Like, mm-hmm. they got right on it. And my friend Jared Youngman, who is the president of the Utah officials, the joint board president, Jared Youngman, he's the guy you want to kick ass when you need someone to go kick ass for you. And he did. So thank you, Jared. Okay.
All right, here's another question. This is a general question, I guess, for all of us from Jill in Draper. What do you believe is the biggest change that you have made in someone's life because of your position on Radio from Hell? You know what? It's funny. Yeah. It's because I just had somebody talk to me about, you know, how much you've been on the radio for so long and how much your show has meant to me. And I mean, I have a hard time fathoming it. You know, I want to say, oh, come on, really? get what? This is just a dumb radio show. But there, it's meant a lot to some people.
Yeah.
And I don't mean to pee on that or that it somehow has meant a lot to you. But I don't get how that happens.
Yeah, see, I can't answer this question, really.
Yeah,
I mean, people have said to me things, but I don't feel right about, you know, repeating them because it just seems, you know, like I'm more important than I am.
Yeah.
You know?
It's very flattering.
It is.
And it also makes me sometimes feel that I need to be a little bit more responsible about what I do and say on the radio. But
I get that.
But then I don't.
Hmm.
So I
think of the big picture, the impact that you and this show and this radio station have been able to have on the community where the things we do with, like, at the Road Home at Christmas time,
mm-hmm.
You know, being one of the first commercial entities to embrace the Pride Parade, like the first commercial radio station to be in it.
Yeah, we were the first radio station to be in it.
So I think
we had to fight like hell to get there.
Yeah, and I think those...
And not with the parade people.
Not with the parade people.
With our people.
They were happy to have us.
The big things like that, I think that's an easy thing. Mm-hmm. But like I remember the pandemic, for example, which was terrifying. And I listened, and I'm a fan of the show, and I listened to you, to the show, to Radio from Hell, just to kind of get me through it, because we were kind of all going through this weird thing together.
Yeah.
And I needed my morning show buddies to, you know, be there with me during it.
I saw, it's just funny, I was thinking about that the other day. And I remember I first started doing, when we started doing the show from home because of the pandemic, and I was doing it downstairs, sitting at my kitchen table. where I have a big view of the street outside, and I live on a very busy thoroughfare, and there was just nobody every morning. And I'd be looking out there, and I felt like I was in a post-apocalyptic movie of some sort.
It was so bizarre. And so just hearing, just having that there, that thing that I like that was live and local.
Here's a couple of texts. First three examples that come to mind, the road home, 9/11.
That was another good
the
one,
day of the earthquake.
Yeah.
Bill came to my house to finish the show.
Yeah.
That was we were sharing a microphone because the home studio wasn't done. Mm-hmm. And the pandemic had just become a big major thing. Mm-hmm. And we're sharing a microphone sitting right next to each other doing a show at my house.
You guys have helped me so much just by reading a check-in that I put up when I was having a really hard mental health day. I appreciate it and feeling seen. Hmm. Our son Kyle was impactful.
Oh, yeah, Kyle.
Let's see. The reason you influence people so much in their life is because you guys are personable on air and off. Don't you know who you are? You mean a lot to many people. And then this one's my favorite one. There isn't always meaning to everything we do.
Yeah, well,
there you go.
Yeah. I mean, it is, after all, the morning show that has the feature called Farting Around.
After all.
All right, that's it. The best question of the week. Thanks for sending them in. And if you have any queries that you would like to make, radiofromhell@x96.com.
Yes.
Traffic is, it's okay today. Just your basic usual delays. I think, Friday, people are working from home or just checking out entirely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you got your usual delays, not like yesterday.
All right. KXRK Provo, speaking of impactful, Jimmy the Wine Guy is here next. He's going to... Yeah. Get us some cocktails for the weekend.
Made a big impact on my life, I can tell you that right now. Is he making cocktails?
I was looking to see what he was making out there. I can't see. He's standing just so I can't see what he's doing. All right, we'll have that for you coming up after these messages. Stand by. RANLife.com/X96.
Speaking of impact on the community, mm-hmm. RAN Life has been a mortgage company here along the Wasatch Front for, certainly at least 25 years, I would think. And they've been my mortgager. Okay. Anyway, you can qualify for a home loan with an incredible 3.75% interest rate and RAN Life's 3-in-1 adjustable rate mortgage. Now, that 3-in-1 arm is a golden ticket to unlocking affordability on the home that you've always dreamed of. With the 3.75% interest rate, you can qualify for a bigger loan amount, get a lower mortgage payment, and turn your dream into an address. So contact ranlife.com/X96. They have some of the best loan pricing and loan officers in the game. Reach out and learn more. ranlife.com/X96. On approval of credit and restrictions do apply. 3.75% interest rate and APR is 6.97%.
You know, you can always count on Gina Barbera.
Radio from Hell with another list, because people love a good list. X96.
That says, Gina, people love a good list.
Oh, this is a good
list. It says it right.
Oh, yeah.
There.
I made her look at it.
Oh.
Not just read the headline.
Not just read the headline and go with it. I heard you say, Gina said, which one? Well, you read them.
What animal kills the most humans?
You want me to guess?
Yes.
Animal kills the most humans.
About hippos.
Yes.
And hippos, they're so cute.
Sure,
you think they would not be dangerous.
They're not.
Yes, they are. I've told you my hippo story, haven't I? And apparently this happened a lot. There was a hippo at the zoo. Mm-hmm. The zoo, I don't know if he's still the same one. But you go up and you look at him and he turns his backside towards the crowd. And then he starts letting the stream of fecal matter come out and twirls and splatters all over the ground. And apparently does that all the time.
Now that won't kill you, though.
No.
Hippos are dangerous. I've watched enough Disney documentaries. No, they can be dangerous. A bloat of hippo.
Now, they're not number one. I'm going backwards.
Oh, you're going backwards. Go
down, count down to number one.
I'm going to say I'm going to say sheep.
So there
I have personal experience.
How many on the list?
Next is elephants.
Elephants.
They're nice.
Oh, no, they're all over.
500 deaths a year.
Wow.
1,000 deaths a year for saltwater crocodile.
Hmm.
Hmm. 2,500 deaths a year for roundworms.
Oh, well, then considering the parasite and animal.
We're factoring that. Yeah.
Scorpions. 2,600 deaths per year.
Let's move to Arizona. I've been stung by scorpions a couple of times.
Something I have never heard of before, an assassin bug.
Oh, yeah, they're like a wasp.
Which will... the bite will kill you.
Yes. Yes, it will. I believe that's what my... We weren't sure, but my mother-in-law... She came over to the house one time, and her hand was bandaged up, and I said... Why aren't you? We're going to the Institute right now. And that was probably what that was.
And I did look. We have them here.
Yeah, we do.
10,000 deaths a year for the assassin bug.
If she'd let that go, it would have, you know, killed her.
A viper, a snake. Okay,
snake,
a snake makes
sense. Okay,
snakes
make sense.
138,000 deaths a year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
200,000 deaths a year from freshwater snails. And you're going to ask me...
Freshwater snails?
How do freshwater snails kill you?
Is it people eating them?
Are they poison?
You can get schistosomiasis, which is a super fun word to say.
Oh. Ask your doctor about schistosomiasis.
It's a parasite you can get. Yeah. The parasite leaves the snail and enters the water, where it can enter a person's body through the skin or when a person wades or swims in contaminated fresh water.
Mm. Now the chat room has put up a picture of the assassin bug. I've seen the assassin bug.
It will kill you. Stay away from it.
Wow, okay. Oh, and the hippo you're talking about, his name is Mo, and apparently he lives in New Mexico now.
Wow. But people remember
People remember.
He did that all the time.
He's spraying New Mexico. Yes. But number one animal that kills 725,000 people a year.
Sheep.
Mosquitoes. You got your dengue fever, you got your yellow fever, you got your malaria, you got your...
I'm surprised. Isn't the tsetse fly on there anywhere?
It is not. It is not on there. Now you're saying, well, now, isn't the most dangerous animal for humans other humans?
Well, yes.
Man.
So 475,000 humans kill other humans a year, but mosquitoes kill 725,000. So we still...
We got, come on, mosquitoes. Folks. We got to catch up to the mosquitoes. just start killing.
You want to be number one?
It's man, Bambi.
Man.
Assassin bug. So we do have a picture of the assassin. I need to know what to look out
for. It's in the chat room.
They look kind of like a wasp.
Guy has found a picture of him in the chat room, and I swear I've seen
one
of those hanging out.
I'm sure. I couldn't be positive that that's what got my mother-in-law, but it was pretty bad.
Yeah. I don't need more things to worry about.
Now, a guy in the chat room says that tsetse flies are 10,000 a year per Wikipedia.
Well, I mean, I don't know where this list.
Brett's just sad that there are no lions, tigers, or bears.
Oh, my.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Tapeworms, number 10. Oh, this is kind of a different list, but tapeworms kill a lot of people.
Tapeworms would, yeah.
This says you're more likely to be killed by a falling coconut than a shark. So stop worrying about...
Well, what about my coconut trees that I have in my backyard?
Stop worrying about...
8-6.
You know who's excited and listening right now? Our buddy Phil in Kaysville. He's just doing the best that he can, but Kaysville.
Did he move to Kaysville?
Yeah, I guess he moved to Kaysville. I thought he was Phil in Magna.
I'm talking about the Phil.
Yeah. Oh.
Not that Phil, but the Phil from Kaysville who's just doing the best.
Okay. Yeah. Kaysville.
Doing the best he can.
Well, let's get to it. Have another drink with Jimmy the Wine Guy. Is it sponsored?
It is brought to you by Rocky Mountain Mixers, your locally owned and operated Mixers and More store, offering Utah's widest selection of mixers in one location, located just east of the Cottonwood Heights Liquor Store on Fort Union Boulevard, or visit them online at rockymixers.com.
So what? Oh, wait, I got your theme. I swear I have your theme song here, Jimmy. I swear.
By the Kinks.
Yep. If you feel all right, if you feel down and you're
under the weather, have another drink and you feel all right. Well, he's here in the studio with us, the potentate of the Wine Academy of Utah, Jimmy Santangelo, or Jim Santangelo, as some call him.
James.
WineAcademyOfUtah.com. He's poured the wine. Good morning, Mr. Santangelo.
Good morning.
What we drinking?
We have a product by CSUN, Chuck Wagner out of California of Camus Cabernet Sauvignon fame, Mère Soleil. He used to make Meiomi. And this is CSUN. It's clocking in at $15.99 per bottle this month. It's on sale from $19.99.
Is this a Cabernet? Or a
this is Chardonnay and a Pinot Noir that I'm featuring for you. And what CSUN does is they source the fruit out of Monterey County, Santa Barbara County, even Sassoon Valley, which is about 30 miles southeast of Napa, really up-and-coming region sourcing fruit. All these regions that they're sourcing the grapes from are coastal regions other than this Sassoon Valley. And that means you get those cooling breezes from the ocean. You got extended hang time or the little longer growing season, so the fruit comes about really nice and ripe. And we're featuring the Chardonnay and the Pinot Noir by CSUN.
Now, this Chardonnay, I was going to say, it's almost like, to me, almost like a Sauvignon Blanc or something.
Yeah.
It's not oaky in the slightest.
Yeah.
It's kind of tangy.
Yeah, the tangy is the acid. What I like about this wine, and they describe it, and it's pretty spot on, that it's this lush flavor, good body, not oaky, though, like a creamy for the Chard. And then the acid comes through. So you get it's very well balanced. I mean, I would call this also a cocktail Chard in that you're not making a cocktail with it, but you can have it just on its own. It's going to pair just on its own. It's not craving food.
Yeah.
But if I were to have food, I would have something, you know, like avocado toast. If you if you're looking for a wine to pair with breakfast out there,
there you go.
This is a wine for you. But cream sauces or just a little simple charcuterie. You don't have to go crazy with it.
Yeah, but the cream sauces, it would cut right through the cream sauce.
Yeah.
Yeah, really good.
Let me have you taste a little bit of the Pinot if you want.
I would have the Chardonnay with buttered noodles for hell's sake.
Sure.
A little buttered rice.
It's
delicious.
White,
I love it.
White rice with butter.
Yeah. I'm going to point something out. I listened to the Jimmy segment at home just on the radio.
Yeah.
And I picture Jimmy's in here with a whole bunch of notes. He's not.
No.
This is just coming out of his brain.
No,
he's a
Jedi when it comes to
this. This is frightening watching you just like dispense these
Well, I was
facts.
Well-trained, you know, and one of my mentors, my buddy Perry Hermides, taught me something really important early on. He said, I asked him, I'm like, how am I supposed to approach wine to learn about all this stuff? And he's like, geography. You got to know the place and where it's from.
Exactly.
And that was the best advice, and it allowed me to structure everything.
Exactly.
So when I think about California, all those coastal influences and everything, then you know a little bit about the producer and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
Here's this Pinot also coming in on sale from $20 to $15 or $16, $15.99. Beautiful color on this.
It's delicious.
It's very good.
There's a
kind 2021 of sweetness vintage. To it.
There is.
Yeah, that's that ripeness coming through.
Here's the thing, Jimmy. I'm a little angry at you for featuring this wine.
Why is that?
Because this has been my secret label.
Oh.
And now you're telling everybody about
it. All the kids are going
to
know.
Hold up the label to the camera. That's not an attractive label.
I mean, it's not something that reaches out and grabs you.
Yeah, and
it's
people
just
have been
of fact.
And people have been passing it by because the label doesn't get their attention.
Oh,
but I know that that's a good wine inside there.
You know, they pass that label by. You know why? There's not an animal on it.
It's true. It used to be when I'd buy that Chardonnay, I would be the one buying it,
yeah,
and I knew
around, nobody knows
because they were covered with dust in the liquor store, right? But ever since we've talked about this one, we did about a year ago. I know we talked about this one.
Yeah, that's right.
It's been
your go-to.
It's been off the shelves.
Oh,
everyone's going to it.
It's everyone's going. Yeah,
because they've discovered it's a delicious wine, but you know, not an attractive label.
It's a second and third label from one of the top producers out of California, if not the world. Seriously, the Wagner family.
Yeah.
I started liking red wine, Merlot, probably because of the movie Sideways.
Sure.
But
I'm gonna drink a damn Merlot.
But I thought that's the one that tastes most like fruit to me.
Mm.
You know, wine comes from It's a fruit. It's grapes. Yeah. Super, tastes grapey and fruity. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This Pinot is pretty.
It's delicious.
Fruity. Yeah.
It's a delicious Pinot.
Just taking a peek at the alcohol level. Okay. That says keep away from open flame. Mm-hmm. Yeah, these are a little high in hot. So on average, wines are 13.5% alcohol by volume. The Chard's about 14.3 and the Pinot's 14.7. So the sweetness that you're getting in there is that feeling of the alcohol on the palate. Also, it's concentrated fruit. It's long hang time, so you're going to get this really rich ripeness. The reason it's so high alcohol, a lot of sugar in that grape to convert it. So there's no, like, residual sugar in here. There's no, like, granulated sugar in there to make it sweet, but it has that appearance.
You know what? This makes me want to have some pork chops.
Nice.
Pork chops. I want to have some fried pork chops.
Mm-hmm. Pork chops and applesauce.
A little applesauce. Yeah. A little gravy.
That
maybe.
Would be good.
Nice. Mm. Nice. Yeah, these are two. If I was an operator, I'd have at least one of two of these on the Wines by the Glass list for sure. And definitely, it's on sale till the end of the month. So definitely pick up half a case because it's only $16.
And what's the brand again?
CSUN.
CSUN.
Yeah. Okay. So their big brother, and I don't know if we're out of time. The big brother is called Mare Soleil, which is that translation as well.
Oh.
So the Mare Soleil are the single vineyard stuff.
Okay.
So if you like this, forget about it. You're gonna love the Mare Soleils out there.
Oh, damn! All right. Here's a texter checking in from Montecantini, Italy, aka the Chianti region.
Oh, nice.
Listening on the app. Buonasera, friends. Love Harry.
Thanks for listening.
Yeah, question for Jimmy. Is there a good mead that we can purchase in Utah?
The outfit up in northern Utah, why am I forgetting? Chris, he has it up there. Email me. I'll send you it. Yes, there are. To answer your question, they're readily available. And it's a local producer just over there in Bountiful.
Mm, this is delicious.
Cool.
So good. Thank you, Jimmy. Well, what do you got going?
If you want to learn more things, next week on Monday, I have a rum and chocolate tasting through the U of U Lifelong Learning.
Mm.
A few more tickets left there. This Saturday, History of the Martini at the Private Club Edison House, if you remember reach out. And then next Thursday, we have a few tickets left. Thursday, 3/28 at Leo Libations, wine pairing at the Leonardo Museum.
Nice. Oh. Is it Hive Winery that you're talking about?
It is. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Hive Winery does
Hive
the
Winery.
Mead.
Thank you.
They do the mead for you. Well, Jimmy, thank you, as always.
You're welcome. Thanks, guys. Enjoy your weekend.
Remember, go to WineAcademyOfUtah.com for all the information you need about spirits and all of that stuff. Thanks, Jimmy. Mm-hmm.
You got
it. Thank you, Jimmy. Traffic, Todd.
Traffic is brought to you by Jolly and Jolly. If you're a loving dad who only wants the best for his children, they're here to help. For a free consultation and review of your legal rights, call 801-FATHERS, the law office of Jolly and Jolly. We are here to help. Mellow drive today compared to yesterday. I'm really only seeing just your usual residual delays. It's also Friday. It's also kind of a nice day, so I'm betting most people are checking out for the weekend already.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I encourage that.
All right, thank you very much. 8:13 right now, and yes, delicious. sorry. Beat Gina, beat Todd, coming up after these messages. It's Shatner trivia. Because it is his birthday, he is 93 today. But Shatner trivia, you will win what, Todd? What are the tickets?
Todd Newcomb, it is, we got the Blink 182 tickets. You're going to want these because this thing's going to be sold out here soon.
Mm-hmm.
They're here July 11th at the Delta Center.
So Blink 182 tickets, all you have to do is beat Todd at Shatner trivia. It's going to be easy because he knows nothing.
You'll win.
About Shatner. So 877-602-9696, line up. To play Beat Todd, we've got messages and a song, and then we'll play. 877-602-9696. Now, let me take you down memory lane.
Okay.
Just a few years back, the internet brought us a wonderful thing. I love cat videos, and this was one of my favorites.
That's a cat.
That's really a cat.
It's really a cat.
A house cat.
A house cat who appeared to be speaking
and
saying, Old Long Johnson.
Yeah.
Or we projected it onto the poor kitty cat. I don't know. Well, people remember that.
Very well.
And four different people sent me this morning.
Because this is the latest.
Another one, huh?
Well, this is a combo.
Different cat?
This is a combo platter. This is a different cat.
Okay.
And it's a guy who is a musician who calls himself the Kiffness, K-I-F-F, the Kiffness.
Okay.
So he's taken some talking cat samples and turned it into a song.
All right.
So I don't know if you're ready for this or not, but here we go.
Sure.
Oh, it sounds like Pearl Jam.
It does, doesn't it? Now what he's captioned it. So the cat is saying, "Hold on to my fur, I like it when the dogs are barking."
Okay, I hear that.
You hear that?
Yeah.
Okay. So then he's taken his synthesizer and he started doing some samples. You know.
Kitty go purr when you hold on to his fur. Everything a blur.
So there you go.
You could hear Eddie Vedder doing that. Hold on to my frog, the dogs are barking.
And then he's got a dog that it's growling at him, and he's manipulating the jaw to add a little background sound effects. Dog growl there.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. I know you may not think of this much of the song right now.
No,
but
I don't.
I guarantee to you, 4 hours from now, in your head.
I promise you, if this goes viral, you know, like Interscope Records will sign this guy like that.
Get a hold of the Kiffness for Interscope Records. There you go.
I've never experienced a cat in real life sounding like that.
Really?
No, never. I mean, I can't imagine that, you know. I have a cat now that has a distinctive meow and does it all the damn time, but not like it's talking.
Well, we got a new kitten about a year ago, and then within our household, so we have a kitty, an old lady kitty that's like 15, and it took her a minute to decide that she didn't hate the kitten because, you know, kittens are just little buttholes. And my wife had this video of the kitty and the baby kitty and the old kitty together, and the old kitty finally... It's like, all right, fine, I'll lick you and be nice. And so she's licking him, but growling at the same time. So she's being all sweet, licking the kitty, just kind of going, wow, 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 wow. That's the closest to a talking kitty cat.
Yeah, that's the closest I've come to. Nothing sustained like these ones on YouTube. But you know,
and
you...
I like the chattering cat. When you.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I've had cats that do it. When they're looking at birds,
right? A bird or a bug
through the window,
or a laser pointer.
That's a cat.
All right.
No.
Yeah.
that's a cat from the deep south.
It is a southern cat.
Yeah, it's a deep from the deep south.
It is a southern cat. Yeah. It is.
Uh-oh.
There you go.
Where there was a South Park episode where they had the old Long this. Johnson mm-hmm. kitty cat.
People are asking for a link. No. I'll just tell you, it's if you just go to YouTube and look for Hold On To My Fur Talking Cat Song, it'll come up.
Yeah. Or any Pearl Jam song, or it's the same.
Any Pearl Jam is good. Kitty Vedder. La Cure. You see what I did there? All right, because Jimmy was just here. 822. Beat Gina, brought to you by?
It's brought to you by The State Room Presents, bringing you music memories. The State Room is turning 15 years old. Celebrate April 1st with Low Cut Connie live at The State Room. Tickets and camping are available at thestateroompresents.com.
Well, I'd just like to caution Todd Newcomb. Remember, boys don't cry when they lose. Beat Todd.
Hey, now.
I'm your announcer, Johnny Ola. Say, are you feeling not yourself? Are you sluggish? Are things all backed up? You're suffering. Kinda. You're suffering from constipation.
Oh.
Because you don't have to. X-Lax is here to help.
Oh.
X-Lax works gently and effectively to produce a bowel movement. Yes. In as little as 6 to 12 hours. And X-Lax comes in convenient tablet form for dependable overnight constipation treatment.
Oh.
X-Lax. It's relief you can trust. And now, here he is, a man who has always said to me, remember, Johnny, a penny saved is a penny earned, but it's still just a crappy penny.
That's right.
Your host, Terry Jackson.
Thank you, Johnny Ola.
You're welcome.
Professional game show announcer. All right, the randomizer has picked your contestant. Todd, you'll be playing against Brandon today. Hello, Brandon.
Let's go. Hello. Brandon. Let's go.
All right, Brandon. We're going to toss a coin to see who goes first. It will give you an advantage in the game. Heads or tails, call it.
Let's go with heads.
All right. Sure. Heads it is. Sorry, Todd. That means that Brandon goes first.
Brandon, where are you calling from? I need to know my enemy here, so I just need to know everything about you.
I'm calling from Woods Cross.
Okay, okay.
Woods Cross.
All right, so Brandon, the first question is for you. It is multiple choice. Today's topic, Shatner trivia. If you get it correct, you get the point. If not, I'll allow Todd to answer the question correctly and steal your point away, and we'll go back and forth till one of you has 3 points. If you win, Brandon, you will get the Blink 182 tickets.
Yeah, it's Blink 182 tickets. They're going to be in town July 11th at the Delta Center.
But if you lose, what are you prepared to do in Todd's name?
I'm prepared to adopt an animal.
Okay.
All right. Hang on. Okay.
Here we go. If the kids want a dog or a cat.
Did you say adopt or dox?
Adopt.
Adopt. All right, Brandon, first question for you. William Shatner trivia. He is 93 today. All right. First question. Shatner overcame his greatest phobia while directing the Yosemite National Park scenes of Star Trek V, The Final Frontier. What was his phobia? Is it number one, not being recognized? Is it two, chaetophobia, which is the fear of loose or detached hair? Three, fear of falling? Or four, cryptozoophobia, or a fear of Bigfoot?
I'm going to go with three, a fear of falling.
Fear of falling is correct.
Right, because he climbed up El Capitan.
Yes. Yeah. All right.
With a wig. All right, it's 1-0. Todd, it's your turn.
Todd, here's right. your question.
Yes.
Shatner breeds and shows what kind of animals? Is it one, duckbill platypus? Is it two, pie?
I think it's pie.
Okay. Two, horses. Three, Maine Coon house cats. Ooh. Or four, wiener dogs?
Well, I mean, you know, the dachshunds, the wiener dogs are adorable, but he seems, I've seen him on horseback, I'm going to say horses.
Horses.
Yes, that's okay. Right.
Hey, look, that's the first. I've never gotten a thing right ever when I'm in here.
It's 1-1. It's 1-1. And
look out, Brandon. Let's go, buddy.
He does have prize horses.
Yes.
All right, it's Brandon's turn. It's 1-1.
All right. Brandon, Shatner runs Splat Attack. What is Splat Attack? Is it one, a paintball recreation center? Is it two, a video game? Is it three, an S&M dungeon? Or four, a baby wipes company?
As much as I could see, I'm going for three. I'm going to have to go with number one.
Paintball.
Yes.
Paintball.
Yes, it is.
I enjoyed the joke answers on that one.
It's 2-1. Todd, you have a chance to tie it up here.
All right.
Todd?
The baby wipes.
Don't be a dummy.
Shatner owned a red Doberman in the 70s.
Okay.
He owned a red Doberman in the 70s. What was the dog's nickname? Was it one, Spock? Was it two, Hitler? So he could say, heel Hitler.
Ah!
Was it three, Kirk? Or was it four, Samsung Smart Refrigerator?
I'm going to go with Spock.
You'd think that.
Brandon.
Brandon.
Brandon, I think you could win the game right here.
I think he's a little more conceited. I think it's Kirk.
Kirk is correct.
That's right.
I should have known.
Brandon, you win the game handily. Nicely done. You're going to go see Blink 182. Oh, my.
Hang on the line. We'll tell you how to get those tickets.
Listen, I've got to go. I've got a lot of plunging to do.
Oh, my.
That explains.
News brought to you by...
Are you a great gamer? Well, for tabletop games, Magic the Gathering, Dungeons & Dragons, Pokemon, miniatures, dice, paints, and more, Haster Games has it. Located at 6831 South State Street and online at HasterGames.com.
All right. Thank you.
Jake Paul's fight against Mike Tyson is a very talked about event this year, and there's already been a huge amount of speculation regarding the rules. Hmm. After it was announced, heavyweight boxer Derek Chisora claimed that the fight would involve protective headgear and heavier gloves. You wear bigger, pillowy gloves. You wear the big ones, and it almost you can hit anything, and it doesn't hurt, really. But speaking to Radio Raheem, whatever that is, Chisora said, "I know for a fact that they're using 18-ounce gloves and head guards, so we're watching a sparring match. It's an effing joke. You think I'm paying to watch that?" A TikToker soon followed suit with creator More Pick'em Petey repeating the claims. However, one of the promoters involved, Nakisa Bedarian, who is a business partner of Jake Paul's most valuable promotions, recently rubbished the claim about the headgear.
Mm.
Said, no headgear. Jake Paul versus Mike Tyson. What? Canceled after rules pushback? I don't know where that came from. Now Paul himself has hit out against the rumors, calling them absurd, dismissing them in no uncertain terms. He said, "It's sad so many millions of people believe all this." Speaking on the Jake Paul podcast, he says, "It's absurd. First of all, obviously none of it's true. Everybody's so effing stupid who believe that ass shouldn't be allowed to vote." He said, no headgear. But he doesn't address the part about the gloves.
If only there were more hype surrounding this wacky event.
You know, even I'm sort of interested to see what it ultimately ends up being. I would hope that there would be no headgear, and then Mike Tyson would just knock his block off.
Deck him. Yeah. Yeah. Bare-knuckle boxing. Let's go.
Pope Francis on Thursday defrocked a notorious Belgian bishop who admitted 14 years ago that he had sexually abused his nephew, but he faced no punishment from the Vatican at that time. The case of Roger Vengelhuy, the emeritus bishop of Bruges, long ago became a symbol of the Catholic Church's hypocrisy and dysfunction in dealing with cases of abuse. Not only was he allowed to quietly retire after the scandal broke in 2010, but the head of the Belgian Church at the time, Cardinal Godfried Daniels, was caught on tape asking one of his victims to please keep quiet about the abuse, keep it a secret until the bishop leaves office. The Vatican announcement that Francis had defrocked Vengelhuy came a few months before the Pope is due to visit Belgium, where the case would have been an unwelcome and problematic distraction. So the Pope is going to Belgium. Mm-hmm. If he hadn't done this, the Belgians would have been going, ah, what are you coming here for? Huh? You know, nobody's ever done anything about this guy, this Belgian priest.
Mm.
So the Pope took care of it. excuse me. Vengelhuy, who's now 87, shot to international infamy in 2010 amid disclosures that he had abused his young nephew over a dozen years. There were other crimes involved. He made light of them at the time. Mm-hmm. He said, oh, it was just a little bit of a game we played.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It didn't involve rough sex, he said at the time. Shh. I had to have a sip of something. Yeah.
Go ahead.
My throat's dry. A U.S. Department of Education report detailed dozens of cases reported instances of harassment within the Park City School District, along with an agreement as the school district pledges to change. Now, KSL-TV had originally reported on some of the alleged incident of harassment 2 years ago during the window of time covered by the investigation and the report. Those incidents of alleged harassment included racist and anti-Semitic graffiti discovered by high school teacher Josh Goldberg in his classroom. He said he initiated class discussions on hate symbols and racism, but this isn't the first time this has occurred, as I found out now, because many students have come out and spoken to me what they have been experiencing, Goldberg said during an interview. At the time, the school district condemned hate speech and opened an investigation. But on Wednesday, the U.S. Department of Education and Office of Civil Rights released a 30-page letter outlining its report. They said it received seven harassment complaints against the Park City School District in a five-month span just last year.
Hmm.
Even though people have been speaking out about this, KSL's been reporting on it,
mm-hmm.
Apparently Park City School District, they have not addressed it. And the Department of Education is not happy with that. And I would assume that the students are not happy with it, the ones that are being harassed.
But see, this way we can say we've never had an investigation into harassment. Yeah. See, our record is clean.
Yeah. A restroom at Mount Jordan Middle School in Sandy. Students across Utah reported higher rates of feeling somewhat or very unsafe in school restrooms or other unsupervised areas like parking lots at school. Groups of students say it's sometimes uncomfortable in the restroom at a school in San Pete County because students get together and they hang out in the restroom without the teacher's supervision. There are no cameras in there. If something goes down, there's not any record of whatever, except what people say.
Oh, I used to hate junior high. I would hold it until I got home. Like it was, I did not like that.
I don't remember any particular problems except one time at Halloween, I peed all over my skeletons.
Now, there were times I'd go into the bathroom at school and I would immediately see the bully there, and I'd just turn right around and leave.
Yeah. They'd throw yep. Even in high school, the cowboys, they'd yeah. throw their, they'd spit their chew at us new wave kids.
Exactly. Mm. Exactly.
A South Salt Lake distillery closed its beloved bar last week.
Oh.
The Beehive Distilling, 2245 Southwest Temple, announced on Instagram that it would shutter its bar space after 5 years. It was beautiful little,
oh, yeah,
little bar in there.
Mm-hmm.
And last days in business was March 16th. Eric Osling, one of the three partners and owners at Beehive, said it was a difficult decision. Our location is a little off the downtown nightlife scene. And while our fantastic neighborhood is growing rapidly, we just didn't ever achieve the level of traffic that we needed, he said. We'll miss our amazing employees and all of the great people to meet through that experience. Now, it's a wonderful little space.
Mm-hmm.
He said they will reopen it as a rental place for events, parties, private parties and things like that.
All right.
Utah Food Bank got a great donation, 35,000 pounds of pork.
Yay.
You can have your pork chops, Bill.
Bacon. And pork. This is stuff for the food bank, Todd. Oh, I'm not going to take stuff from the food bank. Bacon and other pork products made the Utah Food Bank on March 21st, and the Utah Pork Producers Association partnered with Daly's Premium Meats.
Mm.
You see the Daly's billboards all over, and they make a great bacon. They have great bacon. Anyway, 35,000 pounds of pork for the food bank. That's
nice.
Great.
That's a lot of pork.
Yeah. And finally...
Oh, you got time.
I do? Okay.
Yeah, a couple of minutes.
Consumer safety officials have announced a recall of Starbucks-branded mugs sold in gift sets or individually that could cause serious injuries if exposed to heat.
Well,
that's a bad combination.
You know.
Yeah, the U.S. Consumer Product Safety Commission said that the metallic mugs, which have been sold in 2023 holiday gift sets and branded with Starbucks logo, could overheat or even break if microwaved or filled with very hot liquids. This could cause burns and lacerations. I don't know what you're putting a metallic mug
exactly
in a microwave for, but even putting hot liquid in it, apparently they can crack or break.
Well, that's bad.
The agency said the mug's maker, Nestle USA, issued the recall. And then this story, a pair of Florida women are attempting to create a new Guinness World Record by driving 500 miles all along the state of Florida's coast in toy cars.
Toy car.
Cassie Aaron and her friend Lauren are documenting their adventures on social media after setting off from Friendship Fountain in Jacksonville in a pair of ride-on toy cars. The women are aiming to make the 500-mile drive to the southernmost point buoy in Key West. In a time of about 2 months, the duo said Guinness World Records does not currently list a record holder for the longest distance traveled by toy car, but the record-keeping organization said, okay, we approve your application to inaugurate that category. If you can do it, do it. they're kind of like these little the cars that you buy for your kids that are electric and you're supposed to be able to drive them around
the Barbie one or
the house. Yeah.
Yeah,
these look like two little sports cars. It's the kind of cars that kids always wanted, and I always wanted a car like that when I was a kid. Actually, you know, I'd kind of like to have one now. That they're going to try to raise money for animal charities by doing this, including the Red Panda Network in Nepal, the Costa Rica Animal Rescue Center, and the Save a Fox Rescue in Minnesota, and the World Bird Sanctuary in Missouri.
I love red pandas.
I do, too. Good luck. 500 miles in toy cars.
All right. Sports, weather, traffic.
All righty. Sports, looks like we had a little bit of a disappointing day for BYU in the NCAA tournament. Didn't work out for them. Duquesne beat them. The Utah Utes women's basketball continues in the NCAA tournament. They got a game Saturday night. Someone corrected me. The Utah State University has a game coming up. They are in the tournament. We'll see how that goes. It looks like the other team was heavily favored, but we'll
see.
They're
in the NCAA?
Apparently, according to what someone sent me, yes.
Okay.
I don't know. the Jazz lost yesterday. They're playing Houston tomorrow night. And we're always looking for youth and high school football officials if you want to get in on that. It's fun. You'll love it. You even get paid. Email Todd at x96.com.
Thank you.
Weather brought to you by our friends at Clark Planetarium. See the music at Clark Planetarium at Laser Led Zeppelin. It hits the dome with hits like Kashmir, Immigrant Song, Ramble On, and more. It's now playing at Clark Planetarium every Friday and Saturday night. Plan your visit at clarkplanetarium.org. Weather, enjoy today because it's going to be decent, and then maybe some spotty sprinkles, but then the rain kicks in tomorrow, and it's just going to be kind of rainy for days.
Mm. Yeah. Perfect.
Traffic moving better than yesterday. A few delays we're seeing on 21st South heading into Salt Lake City. Other than that, just your basic drive on a Friday.
All right. Thank you very much. Okay, we will take a break. We'll be right back after these.
Now, let me take you down memory lane.
Okay.
Just a few years back, the internet brought us a wonderful thing. I love cat videos, and this was one of my favorites.
That's really a cat.
That's really a cat.
A house cat.
A house cat who appeared to be speaking
yeah.
and saying, Old Long Johnson.
Yeah.
Or we projected it onto the poor kitty cat. I don't know. Well, people remember that.
Very well.
And four different people sent me this morning because this is the latest.
Another one, huh?
Well, this is a combo.
Different cat?
This is a combo platter. This is a different cat.
Okay.
And it's a guy who is a musician who calls himself the Kiffness, K-I-F-F, the Kiffness.
Okay.
So he's taken some talking cat samples and turned it into a song.
All right.
So I don't know if you're ready for this or not, but here we go.
Sure.
Oh, it sounds like Pearl Jam.
It does, doesn't it? Now, what he's captioned it. So the cat is saying, hold on to my fur, I like it, when the dogs are barking.
Yeah, I hear that.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Okay. So then he's taken his synthesizer and he started doing some samples. And, you know.
Kitty go purr, when you hold on to his fur, everything a blur.
There you go.
You could hear Eddie Vedder doing that. Hold on to my friend, the dogs are barking.
And then he's got a dog that it's growling at him, and he's manipulating the jaw to add a little background sound effects. Dog growl there.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. I know you may not think of this much of the song right now.
No,
but
I don't.
I guarantee to you, 4 hours from now, in your head.
I promise you, if this goes viral, you know, like Interscope Records will sign this guy like that.
Get a hold of the Kiffness for Interscope Records. There you go.
I've never experienced a cat in real life sounding like that.
Really?
No, never. I mean, I can't imagine that, you know. I have a cat now that has a distinctive meow and does it all the damn time, but not like it's talking.
Well, we got a new kitten about a year ago, and mm-hmm. and then within our household, so we have a kitty, an old lady kitty that's like 15, and it took her a minute to decide that she didn't hate the kitten, because, you know, kittens are just little buttholes. And my wife had this video of the kitty and the baby kitty and the old kitty together, and the old kitty finally was like, all right, fine, I'll lick you and be nice. And so she's licking him, but growling.
What is the, he plays a part with Alzheimer's, Shatner?
That was the Boston Legal, wasn't it? He had the mad cow.
He had mad cow.
Oh.
Mad cow.
I don't know.
All right. Anyway, a couple of quick things here. By the way, Brandon, who played beat Gina.
Yes.
Against Todd.
Though, yeah.
If Brandon still wishes to adopt an animal, even though he won, a Bad Wolf Reptile Sanctuary in Orem has a 2-year-old ball python that's ready to find a home.
Oh, the kids will love it.
Immediately. A 7-month-old ball python. So look for Bad Wolf Reptile Sanctuary if you want to adopt a ball.
Update on USU basketball. They've had, apparently this texter's giving me all the information, they've had one of the best seasons of all time.
Right.
TCU only favored by a couple of points. Should be a good game. It's one of the last games tonight just before 8 o'clock. So okay. Go Aggies.
You probably don't know. Is it their first game in the tournament so far?
I have no idea.
You don't know. I have a couple of lists here that we might be interested looking at. Yeah.
Oh.
It's Radio from Hell with another list, because people love a good list. X96.
Did you find the 25 sauce list?
No.
No?
No. No, 28. Oh. I think it was 28, wasn't it?
Sauce, I can't remember.
It's gone. Yeah. But I do have, these are the 8 healthiest Easter candies, according to dietitians.
Are there healthy
Easter candies? And how, and 7 ways lemons can change your life.
Well, what they mean by healthy is less bad for you.
I don't know. Still
bad for you, just not as bad as the others.
I mean, Artie Fufkin has already called out the Easter grass being, you know, is not edible.
It's not edible.
No.
The good news, registered dietitians say it is perfectly fine to eat and enjoy Easter candy, but, you know, you ought to consider a few things when making your Easter candy.
I like the robin's eggs.
Oh, well, moderation, not deprivation, is the heart of my nutrition philosophy, says Elizabeth Shaw, who's a registered dietitian. Here's what you should think about when you're getting your Easter candy. These are the best ones to get, healthiest, if there is such a thing. Lindt milk chocolate mini gold bunnies. So I assume they're little foil wrapped.
Gold bunnies.
I assume they're little foil wrapped gold bunnies.
All right.
One mini bunny has 290 calories and 21 grams of added sugar.
Wow.
But that's less than a full size version.
Wow.
And you don't have to eat the whole thing in one sitting.
Oh, yes, I do.
Yes, you do.
And they're small, so you got to eat like 5 or 6.
Reese's peanut butter eggs.
Oh, I love those.
Yeah. My wife made the mistake of bringing a bag of those home, and they lasted a day and a half.
She says, I love the flavor of these eggs, and there's just 150 calories in 3 of them.
Oh, really?
Plus, the peanut butter does offer some healthy fat and protein.
Okay.
Number 3, Yum Earth jelly beans. I don't know what those are. Mm. Yum Earth jelly beans. They do have portion-controlled packaging. That's why she
And they're made of dirt.
Yeah. 4, Cadbury mini eggs.
I like those.
Those are good. You know, she said they're... they give you 160, a small handful will give you 160 calories and 22 grams of added sugar. But, you know, that's good. And it's a whole handful of them.
Okay.
Hershey's cookies and cream polka dot Easter eggs.
I like those. Yeah.
He said those are good for you. Keep them in your house. You eat 6 candies, only 150 calories.
Well, again, not good for you.
No. I mean, you know, it's not health food, but it's not going to. Ferraro Collection crispy eggs.
Yes.
I assume those have like Rice Krispies.
The little Rice Krispies. Yeah.
Oh, that sounds good.
Number 7, York dark chocolate peppermint patty eggs.
No, dark chocolate's not.
I like dark chocolate okay. I prefer milk chocolate, but I've never been a fan of the chocolate peppermint combination.
Same.
Know? Really?
Yeah. Never like, you know, people love those mint frosted chocolate brownies. And,
oh, yeah. I love those.
Yeah, I don't. And then I don't know what these are either. Twizzlers Eater
maybe it means Easter. Bunnies, probably Easter, it's just a misprint.
Hmm.
Twizzlers, Easter Bunnies, Cherry Candy.
Cherry
if,
candy.
If you like fruity candy, these cute Twizzlers, Easter Bunnies are a great treat for you. They're bite-sized, cherry-flavored, licorice pieces.
No.
I assume they're in the shape of a bunny.
They're just little licorice bunnies.
Yeah, little Twizzler bunnies.
They look like a gummy, but they're a licorice.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so I'd eat those.
Notably absent from that list, Peeps.
Peeps are not there.
And they're not good for you.
Because they're gross. No,
they're
terrible.
The only thing Peeps are good for is putting them in the microwave on high and watching them explode. That's the only.
Somebody knows those jelly beans, and he says they're trash.
They're made with dirt. They're just dirt clods, apparently.
Yeah. I don't.
Jelly beans are just essentially sugar, right?
Yeah. I used to kind of like Jelly Bellies when they were a thing.
The popcorn flavor.
Yeah. I'd like to get the flavors. And they had these little charts where you could mix the flavors. Except there was one Jelly Belly that tasted like fresh-cut grass. And it was just, I don't think it was supposed to. And then there was another one that tasted like Crest toothpaste. So there you go. That's the list of
somebody sent a picture of the Twizzler bunnies. Boy, I'd eat a bag of those. They're just little licorice-shaped like a bunny, but it's like those little bite-sized Twizzlers that you used to get, and they're delicious.
And
I love it.
And they're barely shaped like bunnies.
They're
kind of like bunnies that maybe have big tumors on them.
Glob.
Yeah.
Well, we have time for the...
you want to do the lemons?
The lemon list.
Seven ways lemons can change your life.
Okay, change my life, lemon.
And I'm a fan of lemons myself.
We're lemon snobs at our house. None of that bottled lemon juice. My wife will use fresh lemons.
Of course.
Constantly.
Get a bag of them at Costco.
Number one, lemons are natural cleaning agents.
Yes.
They stand out as widely embraced eco-friendly cleaning solutions, versatile enough to revive kitchen faucets and maintain a sparkling bathroom. And if you've got a stinky food grinder in your sink, disposal, you put a lemon rind down there.
Oh, yeah.
Cleans it right out. An aromatic home freshener.
I love the smell.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite smells.
If you had unwanted odors in your home, you can just slice up some lemons and put them in slice lemons and a handful of cloves in a pan of water.
Mm.
And I think you put it on the stove and just kind of simmer it.
Is that right?
And then the vapors. Oh,
yeah. Katie's agreeing with
right?
you. Yeah.
It's kind of like a potpourri thing, you know? Mm. A garden pest deterrent.
Really?
Lemons, you can create a citrus-based spray by mixing lemon juice with water to protect plants from invaders like ants and aphids.
Hmm.
They are a beauty treatment. Incorporate lemons into your beauty regime, Todd.
are they gonna grow my hair back?
The citric acid acts as a gentle exfoliant, promoting skin renewal. Create a face mask with lemon juice and honey to brighten the complexion, minimize blemishes, and kill bacteria and fight acne.
Okay.
Lemon-infused hair rinse.
Hmm.
Okay, all right. Anti-rust solution.
Really?
Combat rust on metal surfaces by applying a paste made of lemon juice and salt.
Hmm.
It loosens the rust from the metal underneath, and then the salt acts as a gentle abrasive.
Interesting.
And there you go. And finally, it's a do-it-yourself furniture polish.
Hmm.
You can mix up equal parts of lemon juice with white vinegar, mix it well, and you have a spray bottle. Pour the mixture into the bottle. Equal parts, lemon juice, white vinegar, and you can spray it on a cloth and then dust your furniture, and it's nice.
Back in my Golden Corral days, we would clean, we had the glass coffee pots, you know, that restaurants have, and we would clean them. You'd put a scoop of ice and some salt and squeeze some lemon juice in it and just swish it around, and it would clean the coffee pot thing.
I have a glass carafe on one of my coffee pots, and the inside... I don't know how it manages to stain glass, but coffee does.
Try the ice, salt, and lemon juice. It might work.
Yeah, I don't care that it's stained. So,
also, Bill, why don't you go suck a lemon?
I have done that on occasion.
And now we got a texter very upset.
What?
We get the lemon list and no sauce list.
I'm sorry.
This is an outrage. Guy in the chat room found your sauce list.
Oh, did he?
Because he can find anything.
Because, I mean, I accidentally lost it.
Accidentally?
Yes, it was an accident.
Yeah, print it out, guy, and
get it to us.
All right. Is there a link to it, or is it just...
Well, it's in the New York Times. Do you have a New York Times subscription?
Yes.
Okay, if you go in the chat room, click on the link, and it'll come up.
Oh, damn it, it will.
It will.
Damn you.
Damn it, it will.
All right. I'll print it up or put it back in my file.
Just have it standing by.
Oh, okay.
You know, we're out of time now. But
enjoyed another list with Radio from Hell on X96.
Now, people are questioning the salt and lemon with the rust thing because salt creates rust.
Well, you don't leave it on there.
You rinse it off.
Yeah, I mean, it's just for I would assume you leave it on there for a little bit.
Listen, I'm sure on the sauce list there's a sauce that will also fight rust.
There it is. 20 simple sauces that will transform any meal.
There you go.
And also fight rust. The traffic today is better than it was yesterday. I'm only seeing your typical slowdowns. There was a little bit of slowage on 21st South heading into Salt Lake, but even that looks like it's kind of cleared up. So not bad. Well done, folks. Well done.
All right. Thank you very much. We will take a break. We will be back after these messages and a song with the Boner Recap game. Very easy to play, and you should be able to guess it today. Even if you didn't hear it, you should be able to guess
it. You'll know.
But if you did hear it, the question we're going to ask you is, who won the boner this morning? If you didn't hear it and don't want to guess, you could go online, x96.com. The answer is there. What is the prize?
Tickets for Stained and Breaking Benjamin, October 5th at Utah First Credit Union Amphitheater. Get all the concert details about that show and like 100 others on x96.com.
All right. Thank you very much. We'll take a break. We'll be back after a song and play the Boner Recap game. Stand by. UtahAdvocates.com. That is the website.
You know, I'm thinking... if those women in those toy cars driving down to the Key West, if they were in Utah doing that, they might need the advocates. If you've been in an accident and you know it's not your fault, and you've suffered injuries and you've suffered property loss, damage to your vehicle, or maybe there are other accidents too. They do slip and fall accidents.
Oh, yeah.
Things like that, dog bites and things like that. But call the advocates just to make sure. Find out where you stand. They won't charge you any money out of pocket for the phone call, or if they decide to take your case, they don't charge you any money out of pocket for that either. Mm-hmm. They get when they get an insurance settlement, that's when they get paid.
And this is a boutique kind of shop.
Yeah.
Your attorney lives in Utah, so yeah.
And you can call them 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to find out where you stand. 801-355-5550, or you can go to UtahAdvocates.com. There, you were at FanX how many days?
2 days.
2 days.
But we had a friend in from out of town.
Well, that was convenient.
Which meant that, I was up late, being
because you had company.
Being bartender and all that. Mm-hmm. And, yeah. So getting to bed late each night, then going to FanX on Friday and Saturday, and then we had the bowling thing.
Yeah.
On Sunday.
Which was great fun.
Yeah.
Olympus Hills Lanes. That's close to your house. You didn't have to go.
Yeah, it was a short commute. Yeah. I still managed to be late, though.
But a nice place to take your family for bowling or have a friend group go on a weekend.
And the snack bar or whatever you call it, is that, I think I'm going to go in there and just try a hamburger because they looked great.
They did look good.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think everybody had a good time.
Mm-hmm. People who run the snack bar there, I asked the woman... have you done this for a long time? And I think she says something like 20 years.
That bowling alley's been there a very, very long time.
And she's worked in that snack bar. She said, I love it. I just love talking to people and making them food.
I remember my dad would occasionally bowl up there, in tournaments. They would have them.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I'd swing over and see him bowl. But, it's a good facility. And...
The couple that run it, they don't own it. They're the managers, they were for years and years and years at Orchard Lanes out in Bountiful, or North Salt Lake.
They're longtime bowling people. It sounds like,
and that got torn down so they could make
you know, more apartments, and so they got the job managing that one.
Bowling is one of those great things that people of all ages can do together, kind of on a level playing field kind of thing.
Reasonably level.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. There are people who are way better than others.
Well, yeah, but I mean, it's...
I mean, Spencer, one of our techs,
yeah,
was... Now, that guy can bowl.
He was going on about weighted balls and all of it. He clearly is a bowler.
Well, and Nick...
His wife, Alyssa, said, and he's great at ping pong, too.
Nick took a bowling class.
Yeah, Nick... He got a bachelor's degree in bowling. And he minored in karate.
Well, yeah, I thought on our lane I was going to be the winner, but then here Nick and his bowling class showed up.
Oh, did he come through and
beat me by, I think, 5 points or something like that?
I got a strike, sort of.
I didn't. I mean,
it was my turn to bowl, and I had taken my shoes off, so Carrie played for me.
We were halfway through the second game, and she's just like, I'm done.
Oh, that's it.
And I said, okay, I'll bowl for you. And so I got a strike, and I said, tell everyone you got a strike, Gina. It's right there, scoreboard.
And I didn't roll a single ball.
Yep.
Not one. My job was to wander around and socialize, which I did very well, by the way.
Yeah, you were fantastic at it.
I was good at socializing.
And you were dressed for the part. That's the other thing I appreciated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
See, my bowling got worse in the second game. Because,
hi, Nick.
Hi, guys.
Nick's your buddy, Nick's your pal.
The dangerous part for me was the $12 pitchers of beer. So, yeah.
Is that a good price for somebody? I think Adam said, or somebody said, this is a really good price for Zach.
For a pitcher of beer?
Yeah,
me and Zach were saying, I think this is our new hangout spot after this.
Because just go and drink beer there.
We'll get done with shifts, and then we'll just go get a pitcher and bowl away.
Mm-hmm. I don't think you even have to bowl. You can just have a beer.
Oh, yeah.
Can you?
Sure. Yeah.
How would they know?
You're selling it harder for me.
You can just
go and have lunch there.
Sure.
Okay.
They don't care.
All right.
There's a counter up there where the snack bar, whatever you call it, is. So you can get a pitcher of beer and a hamburger and sit up there.
Do you think they'll get mad if I get, like, burger grease all over the bowling balls?
Yeah, don't do that.
Yeah, don't do that.
Right.
Be tidy about the whole thing.
Oh, and they're hiring.
Hey, there you go.
I just went to their website.
Oh, there you go, Nick.
What do they need, pin setters?
Do they need someone to plug the phones back in over and over again?
You're good at that. They're looking for, you could do this. They're looking for a part-time, honest, motivated self-starter.
There's one word there that doesn't work. It's honest.
Responsibilities include cash handling, cooking.
Done that.
Serving beer.
All right. Haven't done that.
Cleaning and customer service.
All but the beer part I've done in the past.
And you could do that.
You could do any of that. And you live close by.
I do. Yeah.
Relatively.
Yeah. I could walk there, right? I put on some bowling shoes, wear them in.
Sure.
Yeah.
I think, Nick, that if you, when radio doesn't work out. So
here
I'm standing. I was standing there with Nick, next to Nick, and up came a family, and said to Nick, "You're our favorite DJ." And I said, "I'm standing right next to him. Come on."
Well, and then they clarified, "You're our favorite morning show host."
Yeah.
You're not really a DJ, Bill.
I haven't talked a lot this morning.
Boy, that
I know
was, that was. Dr. Freud.
There's a reason I do vocal warm-ups a lot of the time.
Here's your employee perks if you decide to take this job.
This would be a good job for you, Nick.
Okay.
You can bowl for free.
Mm-hmm.
Flexible hours.
Perfect.
Fun environment and 50% off food.
What am I doing here?
I have no idea. Yeah. Get out.
We don't offer any of that.
No.
Go now.
My brain is just stewing in its own stress all day here. I could be bowling all day.
What does it pay? Does it say?
It says hourly wage to be discussed. It doesn't.
Okay, well that's to be discussed here as well.
If I were you, I would take my wife with me and have her negotiate the hourly wage. Okay. Because I don't think you're good at it.
Does she strong arm, or?
I don't know. I think she could.
I hope the bowling place is listening right now.
I hope so too.
Yeah,
they do listen to the show. I know they do.
Okay.
It's the bowling place is called Olympus
Lanes. Olympus Hills Lanes.
Olympus Hills Lanes.
Thank you.
Not just the bowling place.
No. Although that's a good name for
I like
bowling
the name, now. Yeah. That'd be good.
It's descriptive. Yeah. It has that benefit. But it is a good facility. I think I'll have to go there again.
Really nice. It's very very clean, very and they have all the latest stuff that you're supposed to have, I guess, in bowling alleys. You know?
What's the latest stuff?
Oh, you know, they have all the animations on the screens and all of that.
Oh, they. I don't know why it didn't let us do it, but you can take your photo as you sign in, and then your photo interacts after the fact whenever you get the strike or, you know, it embarrasses you if you get the gutter ball.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was too much.
You think?
There was a lot of sensory, overload.
There really is a lot of stuff going on.
And then Bill was asking me about scoring, and I'm like, I can't even remember how to score bowling anymore.
I love the over-simulation. I wish they had mobile games playing on the screens up top so I could split my attention several
Well, they had two football games going on.
Yeah. That's not enough for me. No, really? That's not enough for me. I need more.
I just went around to the different lanes and said, we don't allow gambling on this establishment. I want you to know that.
I didn't go over into the – they have a lot of arcade games, too, and I didn't really go over and look at them. They have some good ones.
There was an electronic fishing game. Where it was catch King Lobster to win.
Why do you catch the lobster?
Because it was all fish.
But if you get the lobster,
King Lobster was the anomaly, So if you managed to catch King Lobster, you won.
Right.
And then they would have tickets on the game so you could get prizes.
Mm. And they got pool tables. They got two pool tables, and they got air hockey.
Yeah.
Oh, if we had time, I would have crushed it at pool.
Did you take a class in pool, too?
Unironically, I did.
Well, then we need to have a match between you and Tim the Tree Guy, because Tim was saying that he is a pool hustler.
Really?
And you're complaining about still being in college?
I know. I took a lot of classes sarcastically back in the day, and it's kind of, biting me in the ass.
I took a handball class.
Yeah.
We've hope you'd enjoyed another list with Radio From Hell on X96.
That's the ending part. It's not the.
I got them backwards?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's Radio From Hell with another list because people love a good list. X96.
Hey, Carrie, you need to tell me which one of these you want.
Okay.
Crazy celebrity facts you won't believe are true.
All right.
Celebrities who were already rich before they became famous.
Okay.
Stingiest celebrities.
Yeah.
Or celebrities with criminal parents.
Criminal parents. What were the first two?
The first one was crazy facts you won't believe.
Okay.
That's kind of general.
Yeah.
Or celebrities who were already rich before they became famous.
The first one. The crazy facts.
Because, you won't believe are true.
All right.
I bet you know some of these facts, and you know that they're true.
Okay.
Charlie Sheen.
Yes.
Not only believes in the Loch Ness Monster, but he came this close to catching it once, he tells me.
You know, we're worried about Kanye West. When I didn't see this outpouring of worry with Charlie Sheen. I didn't see it. When...
Well, here's another one. Rob Lowe.
I hear he is nuts.
Claims to have encountered Bigfoot. And that Bigfoot is real.
He has encountered Bigfoot.
Mm-hmm. No pictures or evidence or...
Literally Bigfoot.
Lucy Liu?
Whose birthday it is today.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
She claims she has made love to a spirit before.
Oh, Lucy.
I think that's a... That's a dream.
Yeah, that's a dream, Lucy. It's a different thing.
Mariah Carey.
Oh, she's nuts, yeah.
Sleeps 15 hours a day in a room full of dehumidifiers. Now, you would think she would have a humidifier.
I would think, yes.
I believe she sleeps 15.
Listening in Murray, Milton in Murray. Eurythmics.
Well, because Murray likes vinyl.
They do.
Mm-hmm. 45.
Yeah. Murray is very popular in, vinyl is very popular in Murray.
All right. Let's see. Oh, 9:10. Let's get to the Boner recap game.
All right. Let's get to what do we have as a prize for that?
So, man? Well, first of all, it's brought to you by our friends at Cat and Cauldron. Experience the magic and enchantment of Cat and Cauldron, your premier destination for all things occult and metaphysical, right there in Taylorsville. Go to catandcauldron.com. And we're playing for tickets to see Stained and Breaking Benjamin on the 5th of October at Utah First Credit Union Amphitheater. Concert details can be found at x96.com.
And who do we have to play?
Zach is here.
Zach, hi.
Hi.
Hey, where are you calling from?
I'm in Salt Lake right now.
All right, Zach. Did you hear the Boner candidates earlier today?
I did.
It'll be easy, easy. This is a pretty easy one anyway. Mm-hmm. But you're going to win tickets to see Stained and Breaking Benjamin, I feel certain. Here are the candidates. You tell me the winner. Number one was, again with the honking and the shooting. We had a case of this earlier in the week, a local case, where some people were sentenced for shooting at a Amazon driver because the Amazon driver honked at them because they'd cut him off in traffic. And so these guys came back and shot at the Amazon driver. This case happened in Indiana, I believe. A 17-year-old girl had the scare of her life when somebody shot at her for honking at her because somebody had cut her off and she honked, and then they came back around and shot up her car. Didn't hurt her, thank goodness. Number two was $5,000 for two of them. That's a bargain. It's about a Kentucky so-called mother and father who were arrested recently for allegedly trying to sell their newborn twin daughters for $5,000. It's a bargain. And then Boner candidate number three was they spelled out a racial slur with crackers, soda crackers specifically. Saratoga Springs family wants more done. Their son was a victim of a racist act at a convention with a high school group, FFA. The young man was all day at the convention. He comes back to his hotel room, and somebody had vandalized the room, seriously vandalized it, and spelled out the letters N-I-G in soda crackers. I believe this is a young man of color. And he says people at the high school use that word all the time. So those were the three candidates. Zach, who was the winner?
I believe it was number three.
You believe correctly.
That is correct.
Congratulations. You will be going to see Stained and Breaking Benjamin. Enjoy the show, Zach, and hang on the line. Somebody will tell you what you need to do next.
There you go. Pretty easy.
Oh. I've got this.
Yes?
I've had this ring on my right hand for years. I don't know how many years. I think maybe longer than I've had my wedding ring.
Really?
I think my wife bought me, as I recall, my wife bought me this ring at some kind of a fair at the University of Utah.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I recall. And this is way before we were married. And I've had it, and it's got, I don't know, it's got little Indian Native American symbols on it of some sort. Mm-hmm. Silver ring, mm-hmm. Nice little ring. I just noticed this morning it broke. It just cracked right in.
Oh. Oh, my.
It, you know, I can't wear it that way, really. It's going to either get lost or get caught on something. It's not a, you know, it was nothing expensive, but I would assume somebody could fix that.
I know someone that can fix that.
Yeah?
Yeah. Blind Lux Jewelry.
Blind
the guy,
Lux?
The guy that made the this, what I'm wearing, my Martin Gore safety pin pearl strand necklace.
I was going to ask.
He does jewelry.
Where is he?
It's Brogan.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's Brogan Kelby?
Yes.
And he also does
jewelry?
He
does jewelry, yeah.
So will you just take this and have him fix
it
for me?
Yeah, he'll fix it totally.
Well, okay. Yeah. Thanks.
No, he does. He fixed some rings for my mom. Like, he's just this insane jeweler as well now.
Wow.
I think it is silver, but.
Yeah, he can fix it.
But there was probably a seam there or something.
Hmm.
And it's just, I've worn it for so long, it wore through.
Interesting.
All right. Anyway. I'd hate to lose it.
We'll get it taken care of, Bill.
Okay,
we got you.
Bob.
We got you.
We got it covered.
That's,
all right.
Man, I'm glad I brought it up.
Bill's Ring brought to you by Nick Davis, broadcasting live tomorrow at Tim Daly Mazda in Murray, 4528 South State. He's there from 1 to 3. You'll have the usual Nick Davis charm. I mean, he is
yes.
one of our favorite humans yes, on Earth. We just adore him. But he'll have also free stuff, including tickets for Motion City Soundtrack.
Ooh, that'd be a good show. All right, we will take a break. We'll be back with your big boy news after these. Stand by.
And now, in spite of our better judgment and contrary to the advice from radio and game show professionals everywhere, we present to you, whether you want it or not, another fast-paced episode of Beat Gina. I'm Beat Gina Booth announcer and handsome guy, Johnny O. We'll begin our game in a moment, but first this.
Yes.
Say, Mr. Pipe Smoker, do you know why more pipes smoke Prince Albert than any other tobacco?
Oh.
Well, just try a pipeful. Then you'll know. Just taste the extra rich flavor of Prince Albert's Choice Tobacco. See if you don't prefer Prince Albert's cool mildness. Prince Albert is specially treated to ensure against tongue bite.
Ooh.
Crimp. Cut to burn slow and smoke cool. Yes, Prince Albert is specially made for smoking pleasure. See if you don't enjoy your pipe more with Prince Albert. And be sure to listen to Prince Albert's Grand Old Opry Saturday night
Ooh.
For a half hour of folk songs and humor with Red Foley, Minnie Pearl, Rob Bashfield, and the rest of the Opry gang.
I never miss it.
And as Red's special guest, those musical dining sisters... Those musical dinning sisters.
Ooh. Oh, huh?
The dinning sisters.
The dinning sisters.
That's who it is,
okay,
the dinning
right.
sisters. Remember, Prince Albert's Grand Old Opry Saturday night
mm-hmm.
over most NBC radio network stations.
Yes.
And now, here's a man who's called America's best game show host, and you can put that in your pipe and smoke it.
Thank you.
He's the one, the only, Kerry Jackson.
Oh, thank you, Johnny Ola.
You're welcome.
Professional game show announcer.
Dining sisters. Dinnings.
Dinnings sisters.
Dinnings. I believe it's Dinnings sisters.
The randomizer has picked a contestant, Gina. It looks like Dominic is here.
Hi, Dominic.
Hello. Good morning.
Right. Dominic, you ready to play? Let's toss a coin to see who goes first. It will give you an advantage in the game. You call it heads or tails, please.
Tails.
All right. Coin toss app says... Tails, Gina
oh,
Barbarian.
That's the first,
whoa.
That's the first time I've lost the toss in
couple of weeks.
A while.
Yeah. A few weeks, yeah.
Well, you're one step closer. Yeah, you're one step closer, Dominic, to winning these tickets to see comedian Steve Trevino at the Capitol Theater on February 4th.
All right, so you're going to get those tickets if you beat Gina. We've got some leftover questions from our show yesterday. And then some leftover from last week. So
okay.
You don't know what the subjects will be. These first three will be about movies filmed in Utah, trivia
okay.
from our Lights, Camera, Brunch. These are leftover questions, the clean ones. So, Dominic, first question is for you. They're multiple choice. If you get it correct, you'll get the point. If not, I will allow Gina to answer the question, stealing your point away, and we'll go back and forth till one of you gets 3 points. Dominic, first question for you. According to catcountryutah.com, what is the most popular film made in Utah? The most popular film made in Utah. Dominic, is it one, Pirates of the Caribbean at World's End? Is it two, A Dog Took My Face and Gave Me a Better Face to Change the World, the Celeste Cunningham story? Is it three, The Sandlot? Or is it four, Samurai I Amurai?
Gonna have to go for number one.
Pirates of the Caribbean is correct.
I don't know how you got that, Dom.
There you go.
Very one to nothing. It's Gina's
movie.
Gina's turn now.
Anthony Hopkins. All right, Gina.
Yes.
What was Utah once known as in the film industry?
Oh, all right.
This is a little slang term that they came up with for Utah.
Okay.
In the film industry.
Okay.
Is it one, the Dream Abattoir?
Okay.
Is it two, Gollywood? Is it three?
She's easy today, isn't she?
I know, right? Is it three, Van Nuys East? Or is it four, Little Hollywood?
I love Gollywood. I'm going Gollywood.
I wish you wouldn't.
No!
But...
Oh.
Dom, your chance to steal.
Whatever is the answer, it's wrong. It's
I agree.
Radio from Hell.
All right, 9:20 right now. And it is time for Big Boy News and Opinuendo, brought to you by...
it's brought to you by our friends at Living Spaces. You can turn your backyard into a relaxing retreat with Living Spaces. They've got the fresh, inspiring outdoor collections that will create an oasis at home. Embrace the outdoors only with Living Spaces. And I was out there at the big store just off the freeway in Draper. Two words. Maybe it's two words. The two compound words. Outdoor day beds.
You saw them.
I want one.
Oh, you haven't seen them yet, though.
No, I have. I've seen them there at the store, but I want one. I want one at my house. Well, I will spend the summer in an outdoor daybed. I didn't know that was a thing.
Well, sounds lovely.
Get one.
You.
In the age of social media, where every flex and flicker, is meticulously curated, Emmanuel Macron, or as they say on NPR, Emmanuel Macron, appears committed to performing the art of visual rhetoric. You know who that is, right, Todd? Emmanuel Macron?
No.
He's the president of France.
Okay.
His personal photographer.
I didn't know his first name. I just knew Macron.
His personal photographer, Soisin de la Molissonnière, caused quite a stir in France earlier this week when she released two images depicting the French president boxing, pounding a punching bag with his face, a picture of steely resolve as chiseled biceps rippled from beneath his shirt. The black and white shots of Macron were received as a display of ultimate virility, according to the French newspaper Nice Matin. Did you see these photos, by the way?
No.
Many posted that the projection of machismo and strength comes as part of a PR offensive as the French president takes a harder stance on the Russia-Ukraine war.
I was going to ask if they're as good as the shirtless Putin photos that are out there.
he looks pretty tough. I mean, they're well-done photographs, for one thing, but he looks like he knows his way around a punching bag in the gym. And then there's a picture of him reclining and lounging on a couch and not in his boxing gear, just wearing a pair of black pants and a white shirt. And his shirt is open almost to his navel, and he's got a really hairy chest.
A guy in the chat room found a couple of them.
He looks good. And but people are speculating that he's doing this to say, look, don't mess with France, okay? Because I'll pound you. Machine Gun Kelly, on the other hand, doesn't look that great.
Never has.
Megan Fox and Mr. Kelly, MG, are living separately now while working through their rocky relationship, a source tells Us Weekly. Megan Fox is living in Malibu while Machine Gun is staying at their Encino home. They have never married, and now it looks like they're not going to.
This kind of stems back to Ask the program director that we did yesterday. On behalf of me, I would like to apologize for us ever playing
Machine Gun Kelly.
Yeah.
I should have stuck to my guns when I initially thought, absolutely not.
Yeah.
I should not touch this.
I don't think anybody should play Machine Gun Kelly.
Trust your instincts, Todd.
I know it.
Yeah. The couple who got engaged in January of 2022 have no plans for a wedding now anytime soon, but some friends are not convinced that they will end the relationship.
Now, is this just a promotional photo, or is he really tattooed his body it's black everywhere?
I think they said he did.
Yeah, I believe that happened.
Yeah, that's a bad choice.
Well, he's made many bad choices, including getting engaged to Megan Fox,
yeah.
Let's see. Bruce Springsteen made a triumphant return to the stage. I wonder if we have this picture. As he resumed his long-awaited tour on Tuesday night, but some fans took notice of his apparent resemblance to Tilda Swinton. Now, that does not look like Bruce Springsteen to me.
It doesn't, no.
And what's with his...
He looks like Kurt Smith from Tears for Fears.
What's with his... I can't figure out. His shirt is open, and what are we seeing there?
Cleavage. Man cleavage, Bill.
I don't...
That all looks fake to me for some reason.
Yeah, I know.
That doesn't look like... Yeah.
But absolutely, they thought... somebody said, I thought that was Tilda Swinton. in a new role where she plays a wrestler. A fan wrote on Twitter alongside a shocking photo.
Leave Bruce Springsteen alone, damn it.
He's wearing a plaid shirt, partially open, revealing his chest. I can't unsee this, wrote one person. You're telling me that's not Tilda? Oh, my God, I thought it was Tilda, too, another person said. Billy Joel has adopted a new, more eco-friendly or eco-friendly way to commute to work in New York. He takes the train now. The Long Island Railroad.
Oh, good.
I used to take a helicopter, he told Newsweek. I remember that because he had some neighbors.
He's like a daily job. Yes. I mean, really?
Yeah. Explaining that he's changed his mind on account of safety reasons.
He's an accountant downtown.
Well, he should, you know, I mean, but he should change his mind for safety reasons because, as you'll remember, I think she was his ex-wife by this time, but Christy Brinkley was involved in a horrible helicopter accident and was nearly killed, along with a bunch of other people. One of them, a shopping mall baron, I forget his name now. I think she was married to him at the time. Mm. But you remember that one?
Yeah, yeah.
Christy Brinkley got all. But Billy Joel says, now I take the Long Island Railroad as I go into the heart of the city. He's finishing up he's had a residency at Madison Square Garden for quite some time.
And he just takes the train?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I can respect that.
Yeah, he just takes the train.
I'd ride a train with Billy Joel.
Yeah. And he wrote he wrote that song, New York State of Mind, and it's about him riding on a train.
All right.
I'll contact the Make-A-Wish people, and we'll...
I want to ride a train with Billy Joel.
Make that happen.
When you get your life-threatening illness.
All right. Yes. Do that. I think I have it already.
let's see. Blanket. Jackson.
Blanket,
yeah. That's what one of Michael Jackson's kids is named. Michael, I named him Blanket. Blanket Jackson and his grandmother, Catherine Jackson, are caught in a bitter battle involving his late father's estate. And it's escalated to the point where Blanket is taking her to court.
Hmm.
According to court documents obtained by ET, Blanket wants they call him Biggie, apparently.
Ew.
Wants the court. I think Blanket's better than Biggie.
Yeah.
Or is it Biggie? B-I-G-I. It's B-I-G-I. So wants the court to deny his grandmother's request that the estate fork over money to cover attorney's fees that she has incurred in her quest to appeal a court's prior ruling involving the estate. In court documents filed this week in Los Angeles County Superior Court, Blanket says that the fees claimed for legal services for an appeal do not benefit the estate and should not be granted. This family is just... terrible. They're terrible.
The money should go to the kid because he's the most innocent in this whole mess.
Yeah, sure.
Let's see. Apparently, The Who got together with Eddie Vedder. And there is a video. I haven't watched the video yet, but they performed with the Heart of England Orchestra at London's Royal Albert Hall. And surprise guest Eddie Vedder came out near the end to join The Who on the Quadrophenia classic The Punk and the Godfather. The show is part of a week-long series of events at the Royal Albert Hall designed to raise money for the Teenage Cancer Trust. Roger Daltrey has curated the concert series since 2000. He's stepping down this year. The $32 million raised from these concerts has been the foundation for the 28 specialized units within the National Health Service. Is this it?
It's just someone's phone, so it's not...
Eddie Vedder's contribution to the event sounded like this. Again.
I beg your pardon.
Right there.
Eddie Vedder's a good singer.
I love Eddie Vedder. I love Pearl Jam. But it's sometimes hard to understand what he says. And by that, I mean almost all the time. but I love great. So I played Pearl Jam on Todd's turntable yesterday afternoon at 3 o'clock. Please listen to my show in the afternoon.
That's the only reason we have Todd on our show, so he can beg people to listen to his show in the afternoon.
We're number three in afternoons. We're trying.
We can do better.
You can do better.
Yeah.
Well. Okay. Weather.
Spotty sprinkles today and about 66 degrees. Enjoy it because the rain will kick in tomorrow. And it's just going to be rainy for days. Yeah. But spring, you know, yay.
All right. Thank you very much.
Listen to Radio.
at 877-602-9696. Welcome back, Chainsaw Guy.
Well, thanks very much. It's nice to be here. We're waiting for some calls, and I can offer advice to people, but I heard earlier someone named Allison.
Yes.
And she was going to go to a Halloween party as Fred Durst, and she wanted to know what companion she should
take. A companion costume.
Yeah, and I've got the perfect one for her.
You do?
Yeah, you should. It should be a bag of dirt.
Oh.
Just go as a, somebody should go with you as a bag of dirt.
Because he's a dirt bag, yeah. So a bag of dirt.
You know, Gina, you're so quick on the uptake.
I'm like this.
Your mind is sharp.
I'm just trying to impress you, Chainsaw Guy. You're my favorite guest we have on the Radio from Hell Show.
Thank you very
once
much.
A year is thank, all we get you.
Thank you very much. I listen to you sometimes, too.
877-602-9696 is the number to call. And Chainsaw Guy is not just the guy at the end of the haunted house that chases you out with a hockey mask and his chainsaw.
That's right.
Shaking it at you.
Yep.
He is also a life coach. How did you get certified?
I'm proud to say, a self-certified life coach.
Self-certified?
Yes.
There's an online program. It's like how you can you can marry people.
Oh, is that it?
I didn't go that far.
No, you didn't.
He's certified himself.
I just said, hey, right. Guess what, buddy? You're
what?
A life coach.
And tell you what, we will give Radio from Hell trick-or-treat bags.
Oh.
See, the tote bag is
like
now
it.
A trick-or-treat
bag.
Yeah,
I like it.
877-602-9696 if you have a question for Chainsaw Guy. Let's begin with Emily. Hello, Emily.
Hi.
Hi there, Emily. What's your question?
Hi, Chainsaw Guy. My question is, how do I stop drinking so much coffee? I need to quit drinking coffee. So, Chainsaw Guy, what do I do?
Well, if you had to stop drinking coffee, baby, don't wait to take a mess. I have done the commercial, and you put it down, and you put it on. You can use a cork if you want, but I would say there's no harm. And I'd try whiskey.
Whiskey,
yeah.
There you go, all right. There you go. Thank you, Emily. We'll
hang on the line, and we'll get you.
We'll get you your trick or treat bag.
That was a pretty easy one. Really.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
Well, let's go to Jim now.
Okay.
Hello, Jim.
Hey, Jim.
Hey, it's Tim actually, but that's okay.
All right, fine.
Oh, that's Tim. All right. Jim. I don't give a damn.
What's your question for Chainsaw Guy?
Hey, Chainsaw Guy. What should I do? Where should I look for a list of 20 sauces that would enhance any meal that I have?
Oh.
20 sauces that would... I don't think there are 20.
You don't?
I don't think there are 20 sauces that can enhance any meal.
Do you have a list of some sauces that could enhance any meal?
Yeah, I do have a few.
Well?
All right. Okay, here we go. There's red sauce and green sauce. And then you take a sauce, and then you pour, and then you have second sauce, and then you take a tomato sauce, and then tomato sauce. Then you take a tomato, but the very best one is the little whole thing. But what you really want is saucy sauce.
Saucy sauce
is the best one. Yeah.
There you go, Tim. We'll put you on hold, and we'll get you a Radio from Hell trick or treat bag.
I don't think Jim deserves it.
It's Tim. It's Tim.
I don't give a damn.
I don't think you.
833-986.
935.
It was William Shatner's birthday today.
Mm-hmm.
He's 93.
Mm-hmm.
And on Wikipedia, I was looking up the films that he's been in. He's been in 65 movies officially.
Wow.
He's been in, this must be episodes. It says television series 111. He hasn't been in 111 different series. It must be episodes.
Yeah.
So the first movie he was in 1951.
Whoa.
And it's called The Butler's Night Off. And he played a crook, and it doesn't say anything more about it than that. Mm. But then he went on to do, he was in a pretty big movie in 1958 called The Brothers Karamazov. Yul Brynner was in it, Claire Bloom, a big cast. And then, I want to see this one, The Explosive Generation, where he's a high school teacher, and he has to teach the kids, you know, all about morality and all of that kind of thing. But then he was in a huge film, and it's one that I remember seeing when I was a really, really little kid, called Judgment at Nuremberg, which was a gigantic production, and it's a film about the Nuremberg Nazi trials.
Mm.
They captured a bunch of the Nazis, like Adolf Eichmann and those guys, put them on trial, and the film was really controversial because they used, and I remember seeing this as a kid, and it was awful. They used actual newsreel footage of concentration camps and the piles of bodies and things like that at Auschwitz and all of that. And he plays like a young, Shatner plays a young Air Force lawyer in that.
I got a couple of minutes of The Explosive Generation for
you. I just looked that up too. Yeah, thank you for finding it. I was going to tell you to check it out.
The people who planned this course think these are the things that most concern you. I'm taking up a collection.
It looks so young.
Arms. Yeah. What about now? Practically everything on the list is about the future. What about your day-to-day concerns and feelings? Or let me put it this way. How can you decide for yourselves what you want to become until you know who and what you are? Well, I've been wondering about a new list.
All right. Then I say the thing all of us are most concerned with is sex.
Way to go, Jim. Yeah. Hey, way to go, Jim.
Controversial.
We've already discussed sex in health and hygiene.
I'm not talking about venereal disease or how babies are born.
What you mean are personal relations, Janet.
I mean the day-to-day problems you're talking about. Like how far a girl has to go with a boy just to be popular.
What I started to say was that the things you mention are probably much better discussed with your own parents.
Ha! Have you ever tried to talk about sex with my mother?
Well, yes, as a matter of fact,
but
I have.
You know what I mean. The parents aren't the only ones to blame. What about the boys who think they have to prove what big men they are?
Well, since when is it just the boys?
Yeah.
It still takes two, you know.
Well, I'd like... we're the ones who try to keep things in line.
Oh, yeah?
I'd like to try and find a scene from Incubus. It's the movie he filmed entirely. It was filmed entirely in Esperanto. I've heard about this movie, but I've never heard any. I've never seen it. Or do you know what Esperanto was, Todd?
I do not.
It was a language that was created by somebody, I forget who, which was intended to become a universal language that everyone in the world would speak.
Mm-hmm.
And they were serious about it.
Huh? Not unlike Klingon.
They made us just a valley.
So this is Esperanto.
The
aspecto estas muy bona.
Fresh pura aero, lo tendrías en.
Sí, hay un culo estas claras.
Dum la lastai tre noctai mi est ebre domi, sans audi tondon, sans songi pri bataloi.
Sounds kind of French.
Sort of French and sort of a little Spanish. Yeah. It's Esperanto was created to become. And the people who created it really wanted it to be a worldwide language.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, if Pig Latin didn't work out, there was always that.
let's see, what else was he in that was White Comanche? That some real potboilers.
Yeah.
Big Bad Mama, The Devil's Reign, Kingdom of the Spiders.
Yes.
Which was just, I've seen that. You've, Todd, you were saying.
Oh, yeah, that's great. And spiders take over this small town.
Yeah.
Big old tarantulas.
And then finally in 1979, Star Trek, the motion picture.
When did the TV series begin, Carrie?
That was 66.
I think you're right, yeah. He started in 1954 on the Canadian Howdy Doody show. then he was in those episodes of Alfred Hitchcock Presents, which were great.
Mm-hmm.
He was on Ed Sullivan doing something.
Here's Shatner in Big Bad Mama.
Go ahead, Carol. Go ahead yourself.
Got him with a southern accent?
Off by the nose on your face there.
I have to go to the bathroom.
You're a stupid kidnapper. I don't know what to do with it.
He's spending so much time focusing on his cigarette. That's the whole scene, is that he's smoking, and so there's the scene.
Star Trek, the original series, 1966 to 69.
Yep. By the way, if you're just tuning in, Shatner is not dead. Having a memorial. He's fine.
It's his birthday. He's
right?
Fine. He's just fine.
Yes.
He was in an episode of Ironsides. I'm trying to see. Oh, here's his other series. So he went from Star Trek to Owen Marshall, Counselor at Law. he was on that for a year. Before that, he was on an Ironside. So I guess with, what's his name, Big Fat Old Cannon. and then the next series he had was, he was on Star Trek, the animated series. All of them did that, didn't they? All of them?
Yeah, most of them did.
Yeah. And then, I don't see, there's Barbary Coast. 1975 to 1976, Barbary Coast, 14 episodes. That did not work out well.
That's not a hit TV series.
No, it is not.
No, it did not work out well. And then T.J. Hooker comes after that.
Oh, that's right. For all about T.J. Hooker.
Hooker's a good cop.
Yeah.
That was a big deal. That lasted for a bit.
Quite a few years, yeah.
Let's see, T.J. Hooker.
I'm going to say 5 seasons.
1982 to 1986.
All right.
And with Adrian Zmed, of course.
Of course.
And my friend, we've got to do something.
As you can tell, I don't talk like that.
Although the faces seem the same.
This is the way I talk. I talk like this. Okay?
The lives of 430 crewmen stand in the balance.
This is hysterical, really. What show are we on?
Anyway, William Shatner reviews impressions of William Shatner.
Good.
That on YouTube.
Let's see if he's doing anything today.
He's got his documentary is out.
Masters of the Universe Revolution. He's doing voices in.
He's the voice of. He's the voice of Skeletor before he became Skeletor.
He's King. It says it's King Geldor.
Oh no,
Keldor and Skeletor.
Yeah.
And, he's doing that now.
And, his documentary was at Rebecca Frost went and saw it. And she said it's basically 2.5 hours of him rambling.
What is it called, you know?
Bill.
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 Bill. I don't see it here.
All right. Well, let's take a break, play a song, and we'll be back with the boner of the week.
You said you were going to.
I was going to, and then we had things, so I couldn't. But I read about them this morning.
Okay.
And how terrible Joe Coy was at hosting.
Yeah. Apparently he was awful. And some of the, I didn't listen to any of it, but some of the quotes that he said, I went, oh, my God, really? I've never liked him very much anyway. I used to listen to Adam Carolla's podcast, and he was on all the time. And not funny all the time.
He sells out stadiums across the nation. I'm not defending him, but he did get the job
what, 10 days ago?
Which is what he said.
You know, yeah. So...
He said, I'm sorry, some of these jokes aren't landing. I got the job 10 days ago.
Well, and they have writers.
Mm-hmm.
And they just... They were just not funny jokes.
But anyway. here are some of the winners, if not all of them.
I was going to say, there are a lot of them, so...
Let's go. Best... We'll just start at the top here. Yeah. I think they start at the most important ones. Best motion picture drama. And it was Oppenheimer. Killers of the Flower Moon, Maestro, Past Lives, The Zone of Interest, and Anatomy of a Fall, all there, but...
Oppenheimer.
And, you know, I haven't seen any of those others. The only one I have seen is Oppenheimer.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it was great, so there you go. Best Picture, Musical, or a Comedy, not Barbie. Poor Things.
Which was Sean Mean's number one movie of the year, actually.
Yeah, and... It's apparently very good. Emma
Stone.
And Emma Stone won as Best Actor for that movie. Best Director for Motion Picture, it was Christopher Nolan for Oppenheimer.
Yeah.
Which makes sense. I mean, and I never can figure out why the Academy Awards, sometimes Best Picture, and then Best Director is some other, you know, doesn't make sense. Let's see, Best Screenplay Motion Picture. The winner was Anatomy of a Fall.
This is the Holocaust. No, that's a divorce. That's the divorce one. It's the woman who. No, we talked with that. That was on Sean's list too. It's the woman who pushed her husband down the stairs and killed him. And it's
Or threw him over a balcony or something like that.
Yeah.
Best performance by an actor in a musical or in a drama. Excuse me. Bradley Cooper was nominated for Maestro, but did not win. It was Cillian Murphy for. Oppenheimer.
Cooper was really good in Maestro, I'll say that.
I'm sure he was.
I've not seen Oppenheimer yet, so.
Best performance by an actress in a motion picture. The winner, and I believe the first indigenous person to ever win, Lily Gladstone.
For Killers of the Flower Moon.
Yeah. And went up against some really good performances. I understand Carey Mulligan in Maestro is terrific.
She is. She's amazing in it.
Let's see. Best performance by an actress in motion picture, musical, or comedy, Emma Stone for Poor Things. And everything I've read about it says you just can't believe how great she is.
And as good as she is, boy, she just couldn't keep me watching The Curse on HBO or Showtime.
Well, that's because it wasn't her fault.
It's not her fault.
It's just so weird.
Yeah.
Let's see. Best Performance Actor in a Motion Picture Comedy, Musical, or Comedy. It was, the winner was Paul Giamatti.
I liked him in The Holdovers. I thought it was a good movie.
Mm-hmm. Best Supporting Actor, Motion Picture. Winner, Robert Downey Jr., for Oppenheimer, and he was so good, I didn't realize who it was for a bit as I was watching the movie.
That should be why you pick him as best.
Best motion picture, supporting actress in a motion picture. The winner was Divine Joy Randolph in The Holdovers.
She was really good.
I don't know who that is. Television series winner, drama, the best drama, Succession.
Actually, Succession won everything.
A lot of stuff,
won.
Best television series, musical, or comedy. The Bear was the winner.
I have a problem with this.
Why?
That is not a comedy. That is a drama with some comedic elements.
Yeah.
There is some sad, depressing, uncomfortable. The comedy is just sort of peppered in there. I would not put that in a comedy.
I think there's a lot of funny stuff. But you know, okay, here's what it went up against. Ted Lasso. Abbott Elementary, Jury Duty. Oh, that was. I watched about half of that and then.
Yeah, I gave up on it.
I mean, it was interesting, but it wasn't. Only Murders in the Building and Barry. Barry considered a comedy as well. Best performance by an actor in a TV series drama. The winner was Kieran Culkin for Succession, and
they won all the acting
awards. Yeah. And he, I think he said, looked down in the audience. Pedro Pascal was nominated, and he said, "Suck it, Pedro," which Pedro thought was very funny.
Yeah.
And they best performance by an actress in a TV series drama. It was Sarah Snook from Succession, the Emma Stone was nominated for The Curse, and Bella Ramsey was nominated for The Last of Us. Best actress in a TV. Oh, you know who else was nominated for the actress in a TV series drama? Helen Mirren in 1923.
It's good.
She was so damn good in that. Best actress in a TV series, musical, or comedy. The winner was Ayo Edebiri in The Bear. She's the sous chef, right?
Mm-hmm.
Best actor in a TV series comedy. The winner was Jeremy Allen White for Bear.
And he's the least funny person on that show.
He
you're
is,
gonna give
yeah.
it, you give it to Cousin Richie if you're going to
exactly.
give a comedy award to somebody.
Exactly.
No, you give it to the best performers. But I think Cousin Richie is the best performer in that of the men. And particularly that last episode, he's heartbreaking in those last two episodes.
And he was nominated, but he lost out again to Succession, all the Succession that Matthew McFadden yeah. won in
it's
that
all about
Best
Succession.
Supporting Actor.
Matthew McFadden, who plays Sarah Snook's husband. I can't
who is, he's name. My favorite one on the show.
Me too. He yeah. is great in that. I guess is that Ebon Moss
yeah.
Bach?
Yeah,
Bach
that's
Rock?
Cousin Richie.
That's Cousin Richie. Mm-hmm. He's great. Sorry. Oh no.
Are they here
are
for
they,
you?
Yeah, I'm
all right.
So I didn't think they'd come yeah. until after the show, but let's see. The best supporting actress in a TV show was Elizabeth Debicki for The Crown.
This was a surprise because you had Meryl Streep for Only Murders in the Building.
And she was mm-hmm. great in it.
You had
Hannah Waddingham, yeah. And who else? Oh, Christina Ricci is great.
Mm-hmm.
Abby Elliott in The Bear. And yeah, so there
just,
you go.
To close things out, Nick Offerman won a guest star Emmy.
Oh, did he?
For The Last of Us.
Which
Golden
was
Globe.
That,
you mean,
Golden. Or, yeah, a Golden Globe, I mean. Go and find his uh-huh. acceptance speech.
Yep.
It's a beautiful acceptance speech, but his backstage comments were even better. He said, "This part was offered to actors in Hollywood who know how to work a shovel. There are three of us. Harrison Ford turned it down." And
I wonder if that's true, if they offered it to Harrison Ford.
Harrison Ford turned it down, and I forgot the woman. She's in all of those. She's very funny. She plays Steve Martin's stuntman. What's the actor?
Jane Lynch.
And Jane Lynch wasn't available.
That's funny.
So I took it. No, it was just hilarious.
The Utah Film Critics, their best picture pick for the year, Past Lives. Yeah.
Cranberries.
Sorry, I have breaking news over here.
What?
I mean, if I'm in here for Gina, she would want me to report this, but it is now officially confirmed. Kevin Bacon, star of Footloose, going to be returning to Payson High School, where the film was shot, and make an appearance at their prom this year. So it's the 40th anniversary of Footloose, filmed in Payson. And Lehigh Roller Mills, but the school stuff was Payson High School.
My excitement is palpable.
You know, Kevin Bacon was in Friday the 13th, Part 1. Yeah.
Yes, he was.
Yeah.
And they're going to tear down Payson High
School. Yeah, they're going to tear down, so he's going to visit the place.
It's about time.
Being rebuilt.
Yeah.
All right, shall we do the boner of the week and then get out of here?
Yeah.
All right, Dave the Flower Guy is here. Good morning, David.
Good morning.
David, you are ready to go, I would assume.
Yeah.
Okay, because I know you got to get out there and sell some flowers. So.
Yeah, got to get some more.
Okay. Well, here we go. David will select the boner of the week. Monday, number one. Where's Tommy? Where'd you see him, Tommy? Oh, where, Tommy? Where'd you see him? What do they look like, Tommy? What were they doing? Come on, Tommy. We need examples. That was Republican Alabama Senator Tommy Tuberville here in Salt Lake City saying, "I've traveled all over the country, 50 states. I've been in good places, bad places. One thing I see, we're losing our kids to a satanic cult." Oh, yeah? Really? Where are they? Boner candidate number two from Tuesday. "You filthy pigs have no one to blame but yourselves." These people who've just ruined this free beach in California with human waste. And they're just so they have to close the beach down and not allow anyone on it for at least 2 years, they said. Boner candidate number three from Wednesday. "He honked at me." This is the Salt Lake City guy who was honked at by an Amazon driver. And, of course, that justified the guy pulling out a gun and shooting it at the Amazon truck. And then boner candidate number four from yesterday. "They were left to waste." Somebody shot, this is out in Emory County, Utah. Somebody shot a moose and left it there to rot, and at least 18 Canadian geese left to rot. And then finally, this one from today, they spelled out a racial slur with crackers. You've heard them all, David. You listened all week. Which one is the worst?
Number four.
Number four.
Number four, yesterday. They were left to waste.
Yeah. There you go. That's your boner of the week.
Excellent.
Thank you, David. Yeah. All right, let's do the promo and crawl toward the exit, Sam. You ready, Tom?
Yes. I'm not. Wait a second. There it is. Okay.
Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, thanks for letting me be here. I really had a great time, but I don't want to have to wake up freaking early on Monday.
Well, you're off the hook. Gina will be back, so go ahead and sleep in.
But if you sleep in, that means you miss farting around right at 6 a.m.
Okay, so don't sleep in. Join us for Farting Around and more on Monday's Radio from Hell Show, X96. All right.
Lovely.
Fine job as always, Katie. Thank you, Todd, for being here. Live long and prosper, bitches.
Don't you know who I am?
Kevin Bacon's coming back to Payson High School?
Artie Fuck.